Affairs and Information Technology Communications. Kung atin pong matatandaan, sabi po ni Secretary Rio noong nakaraang taon ay mayroon na dapat tayong Common Towers Policy o Guidelines noong December 2017. Ano po bang nangyari? Importante po itong usapin ng Common Towers dahil nabanggit po ni Secretary Rio noong nakaraang pagdinig na nangangailangan tayo ng higit kumulang 50,000 pang cellular towers or 50,000 cellular towers sa ating bansa. Lastly, through this committee, we would mainly delve into the rollout plan of Ms. Latel. Just to be clear, we are not in any way sweeping under the rug all the complaints, arguments, and observations of the other bidders regarding alleged irregularities and abuse of discretion in the selection process of the third telco player. The committee received a substantial number of communications, letters, and information in this regard. And along this line, the committee would like to shed light on the recurring news reports and information claiming that the following personalities allegedly had substantial involvement in the selection process. Sino ba itong sina Ella Blanca Lopez, Teodoro Buenavista Jr., Alvin Bernard Blanco, Samuel Sabile, Andres Castellar Jr., at Cheng Yong? Meron bang isa sa kanila o nandito ba silang lahat ng mga nabanggit ko? Itaas po yung kamay. Maraming salamat. We invited them in today's hearing and basically, please apprise us of your respective roles in the selection process. Kindly tell us your agencies either in the public or private sectors. Ang isa pang interesanteng tanong na lumabas kamakailan ay kung ano itong procurement ng CCTV cameras na manggagaling di umano sa China Telecom. Na siya din ang kaparte ng Ms. Latel Corporation. Mayroon ba itong kinalaman o makakaapekto ba ito sa rollout plan ng Ms. Latel Consortium? To reiterate, this committee will not hesitate to use the full extent of its oversight powers in pursuit of the truth. To uncover the truth and secure the nation are our committee's objectives. The nation deserves no less. Now, the second part of today's public hearing, public services hearing, will be on the 10 legislative franchise applications and 8 bills creating LTO offices. Number one, RT Broadcast Specialist Philippines. Next, Ultimate Entertainment Incorporated. TV5 Network Incorporated. Vimcontu Broadcasting Corporation. Suara SOG or SOG Media Corporation. Cadiz Radio and Television Network. Bases Conversion and Development Authority. Solar para Sabayan Corporation, Magnum Air or Skyjet, Audiovisual Communicators Incorporated. The approved House bills for the establishment of LTO offices, whether regular, district, and licensing offices in various localities are those for Morong Rizal, City of Parañaque, Tanawan City, Batangas, Inguimba, Nueva Ecija, San Jose del Monte, Bulacan, Infanta, Quezon, Lucena City in Quezon, and Mumbarao Oriental, Mindoro. Occidental Mindoro. My apologies, Congresswoman Cortuna. Thank you for your for correcting that. Napaka-importante po nitong mga LTO offices sapagkat dumadami po ang ating populasyon. Kailangan po ng serbisyo, napakahaba po ng pila, kaya ito po ay wala namang problema sa tingin ko ay ma-aproba kaagad-agad dahil serbisyo po ito. So, with that, let me acknowledge the presence of my colleagues with gratitude. Thank you to our minority leader, Senator Franklin Rolon, for your presence today. And of course, ang walang kapagulan, Senator Sunny Trillanes, also the minority. I would also like to acknowledge our counterparts from the House, Congressman Eric Olivares from the 1st District of Parañaque, Congressman Isidro Rodriguez, 2nd District Rizal, my colleague from the Commission on Appointments, Congresswoman Julieta Cortuna, party list representative, a teacher, party list. Gusto lang kita marinig, ma'am. Kaya pa talaga minamali ko yun. Leo Rafael Cueva, 2nd District, Negros Occidental. I would like to ask our guests to please introduce yourselves, beginning, well, we already acknowledge our congressmen and woman. So let's begin with you, sir.
Good morning, Madam Chairperson. I'm Johannes Bernabe from the Philippine Competition Commission.
Good morning, Chairperson. I'm Relu Tu, representing Management Association of the Philippines.
Good morning, Senator. My name is Helen Makasaet from the Management Association of the Philippines.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Attorney Roy Ibay for PLDT.
Good morning, Your Honor. I'm Attorney Froylan Costello from Globe Telecom.
Good morning. I'm Attorney Eric Espanol from Smart Communications.
Good morning. I'm Anne Kathleen Gatula from SEC on behalf of our General Counsel.
Good morning, Your Honors. I'm Adel Tamano, General Counsel for UDENA Corporation.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Danny Sui of UDENA Corporation.
Good morning, Bayani Lara from the Department of Science and Technology.
Good morning, Madam Senator. I'm Ramon Jacinto, Presidential Advisor for Economic Affairs and Information Technology Communications.
Good morning, Madam Chair and honorable members of the committee. I'm Attorney Cordova from the National Telecommunications Commission.
Good morning, Madam Chair and honorable members of the committee. I am Elise Urillo, Acting Secretary of the ICT.
Good morning. I'm Secretary Hermoenes Esperon Jr., National Security Advisor.
Good morning, ma'am. I'm Admiral John De Francisco, the J6 from the General Headquarters Armed Forces of the Philippines.
Good morning. I'm Maria Victoria Castro from National Security Council.
Do you have an opening?
Good morning, ma'am. I'm Major Eli Tingsan from the National Security Council.
Good morning, Your Honors. I'm Attorney Yap, representing NBI Director Dan Tigaran.
Good morning, Madam Chair. I'm Victor Lorenzo of the Cybercrime Division of the NBI.
Good morning, Madam Chair. I'm Renato Garcia from PTMT.
Madam Chair, good morning. My name is Juan Miguel Honorico Lopez. I'm the spokesperson for Now Corporation.
Good morning, Madam Chair. I'm Attorney Ian Baliwag, representing LCS Group of Companies. I'm here respectfully manifesting that Chairman former Governor Luis Chavit Singson will not be able to attend today's hearing as he is still currently outside of the country in connection with his attendance in the recent boxing event of the Honorable Senator Emmanuel Manny Pacquiao.
And who are you representing again? I'm sorry.
I'm representing LCS Group of Companies on behalf of former Governor Singson. He's currently outside
Governor
of the country.
Governor Singson, oh yes, yeah. We know where he was, yes.
Yes, thank you, Your Honors.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Engineer Pierre Tito Gallia of democracy.net.ph.
Good morning, Madam Chair. I'm representing FICTAP.
Good morning, Madam Chair and Honorable Senators. My name is Julian Payne. I'm President of the Canadian Chamber, representing the Joint Foreign Chambers of Commerce, which comprises the American Chamber, Australia-New Zealand Chamber, Canadian Chamber, Japanese Chamber, European Chamber, and Korean Chamber plus Pomeroy. Thank you for inviting us.
Before we begin, I would like to ask our guests to please stand so that we can administer your oath.
Please raise your right hand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in this proceeding? Thank you. For the record, Madam Chair, those who took their oath answered in the affirmative.
Maraming salamat po.
Madam Chair, with your permission,
In your announcement, you gave an order of the bills to be heard, and we noted that a number of these bills concern the creation of the LTOs offices in various parts of the country. It is for this reason that our colleagues in the House are here. I don't have any questions on the establishment of the LTO. I do not know with my colleague, Senator Trillanes, but if the chair and Senator Trillanes would have no questions, may I propose that the insofar as the establishment of the LTO offices are concerned, that the same be deemed submitted for consideration by the plenary, so that our colleagues from the House will be free to leave and would not have to stay for the whole hearing on matters which do not concern the districts. That is my motion, Madam Chair, so that our colleagues from the House will not be bothered and be staying here for the next several hours. So move, Madam Chair.
Yes, I think we will adhere to this particular motion. We definitely thank you for your presence here today, and we will support the creation of an LTO in your districts. Maraming salamat po. Pero pwede kayong manood kung gusto po ninyo, kayo po ay aming panauhin pa rin. Okay. Secretary Rio, pasensya na, kayo dito pa rin hanggang mamaya. I would like to ask if there's an update, a presentation that the DICT would like to begin with, or perhaps the NTC. Meron po bang presentation?
Your Honor, if I may.
Yes, please.
Just an opening, very short statement to give an update to give an update to the committee on the new major player as of this date. A little history: out of the three aspirants, Mr. Tech Consortium was declared the provisional new major player on 7 November 2018. My slide is not yet ready. Anyway, after denying the motion for consideration of SIR Telecom Consortium and PTNT, NTC in bank issued the confirmation order on 19 November. And as per its commitment, Ms. Latel endeavors to deliver 27 megabits of minimum average broadband speed and 55 megabits after 5 years, covering initially 87% of our country on the first year and 84% after 5 years. Next slide, please. Ms. Latel is now undergoing post-qualification, and it is given up to February 17, 2018 to submit all necessary documents for processing before the government, through NTC, will give its certificate of public convenience and necessity, and before the consortium can be given the frequencies it needs to operate as a telco. After that, Madam, the NTC has 15 calendar days to evaluate the submission, and upon written notice, NTC shall require the new major player to submit the performance security. In this case, it's about 25 billion pesos within 15 calendar days. Upon posting and verification of the performance security, then and only then shall NTC issue a CPCN, and that will mark the beginning of year one, where the commitment of Ms. Latel will be recorded, and which is expected to be around March 19 of this year. Next slide, please. There were four concerns that the Oversight Committee had when we were undergoing this election process. And we are glad to tell the body that all four of these concerns have been substantially addressed. No? First is more frequencies to be made available to the new major player. This was accomplished by having, we added in fact 5 megahertz of the 3G frequencies, making in fact the new major player ahead of Globe in terms of these 3G frequencies. And all other frequencies can be shared through a domestic roaming policy, which NTC stated in the last hearing will become this first quarter of this year it will be implementable. So that takes care of the frequency concern, Your Honor. The second concern was less interconnectivity cost for the NMP. In other words, for the subscribers of the new major player to contact and connect to the subscribers of the dominant players, the cost of that connectivity must be lessened. And NTC came up with MC 0507-2018 that will make the interconnection charges, which was then the highest in the ASEAN region, no? 2 pesos and 50 centavos, to now it is one of the lowest, in fact, the lowest in the region of 50 cents. The only country lower than that is Singapore. It is not charging any interconnection charges. And with the law on the portability, that law contains the provision that these interconnection charges will be, again, will be zero. So we are going to that. The third concern was the use of dark fiber of Transco for backbone. MISLATEL Consortium has already signed a joint partnership with the National Transmission Corp, or Transco, for the use of their 2,200 dark fiber as the backbone of the new major player last January 2019. So the third major player can now use the backbone of Transco and will not have to make its own. And the fourth, of course, is the establishment of common towers. And despite some issues on the policy for common towers, DICT proceeded with opening the market for common tower providers, or CTPs, through MOUs. In fact, in the last hearing, we stated that the policy will be implementable before the end of 2018, and we did just that because December 20, the first MOU between DICT and ISOC was signed. No? And ISOC, and right now there are 5 common tower providers that have signed MOUs with us, and they are now going to the different telcos to get business from them. This makes possible, the common tower policy makes possible the entry of $4.4 billion investment for the construction, maintenance, and operation of at least 50,000 common towers in the country, generating hundreds of thousands of jobs. Your Honor, this common tower, the 50,000 to be built, is one of our biggest build program of the DICT. But unlike other programs, DICT does not require any government funds to do this. The foreign investors, local investors, will do this because they will earn business from this. There are other slides, but I think I will just forego with this until the right time for it to be presented. That's all, Your Honors.
Chairperson Cordova, kayo po.
Yes, Madam. Madam Chairman, we're going to present a PowerPoint presentation on the documentary requirements that have to be submitted by the Muslatel Consortium, Muslatel Telco, for the issuance of its Certificate of Public Convenience and Necessity. Okay. Next slide, please. Your Honors, these are the documents to be submitted for the processing of the Certificate of Public Convenience and Necessity for Ms. Latel. Next slide. Based on Section 10.1 of the Terms of Reference for the bidding of the third major player, Ms. Latel has to submit the following. Number one, PCC approval of bidding agreement implementation. Based on an omnibus form statement and undertaking, which was terms of which was given to us by the PCC, Ms. Latel signed and submitted this undertaking as part of their bidding documents. And based on that, PCC issued Commission Resolution Number 27-2018, exempting the new major player from the mandatory merger notification and review requirement under Section 17 of RA 10667, otherwise known as the Philippine Competition Act. Number two, Your Honor, SEC clearance finding the terms of the bidding agreement compliant with the foreign equity ownership. Your Honors, the SEC issued the SEC OGC Opinion Number 18-24, dated December 20, 2018, and found the proposed equity structure in the submitted bidding agreement to be compliant with existing foreign ownership limitations. We can submit a copy of that, Your Honor, and maybe we can ask the SEC to verify the said document. A letter C, congressional approval for the transfer, sale, or assignment of the controlling interest of Mindanao Islamic Telecom Company Incorporated. The House of Representatives Franchise Committee and the plenary has adopted this last December 12th. And we obtained a copy from the House of Representatives, and they have already sent a copy to the Senate last December 18, Your Honors. The business plan, they have until February 17 to submit the business plan. They are now also in the process of authenticating and consolidation of foreign documents. They have until Feb 17 to submit the same. And the rollout plan also, Your Honors, they have until Feb 17 to submit the same. And Section 11, another thing that they have to submit would be the performance security, as mentioned by Secretary Rio earlier. If they have already submitted all the requirements and after evaluation, the NTC finds that everything is in order, we will require Ms. Latel to post the performance security, which is 10% of the capital expenditure that they have bidded out. So that they have bidded, so that will be around 25 billion. Now, Your Honors, there have been several cases that have been filed in relation to this bidding. So we would like to update the Honorable Committee on these cases. There was a case filed before the Supreme Court asking for a temporary restraining order injunction on the bidding, but the Supreme Court did not issue any injunction or TRO, but asked the parties to submit their comments on this case. So the NTC to the Office of the SolGen will file our comment on February 25, which is the day stated in the resolution of the Supreme Court. Another case, Your Honor, is the case filed by PTNT versus NTC and the other parties. A petition for certiorari, the NTC through the Office of the SolGen has already filed its comment on January 20, 2019, if the committee would like a copy of our comment, we will get a copy from the Office of the Solicitor General, as they have just filed their comment last January 20. Another case filed is Now Telecom versus Judge Topacio of RTC Manila. The Now Telecom brought the case to the Court of Appeals from the RTC that denied their petition for the prayer for a TRO and an injunction, so they brought it to the Court of Appeals. So the OSG filed a motion for extension to file our comment, but we will be filing that, Your Honors. And then the last one is the Now Telecom case versus NTC. Before the bidding, Your Honors, Now Telecom filed a case in RTC Manila to praying for an TRO and an injunction, but the court did not issue the injunction. And now, since the case is already moot in academic, the NTC through the Solgen filed a motion to dismiss. So we're still awaiting the decision of that RTC, Your Honor. So far, Your Honor, that's the updates on the bidding. Thank you, Your Honors.
Thank you, Chairperson. I would like to hear now, I think, the update for our national security concern. So if I could have a brief statement from General Esperon regarding this. What is your role with regards to securing our nation's security, sir? Especially when it comes to this particular issue.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, as a member of the Oversight Committee, we are four in the committee. I was involved in the formulation of the document that would become the NTC Memorandum Circular number 0909-2018, which is the rules and regulations on the selection process for the new major player in the Philippine telecommunications market. During the crafting of the memorandum circular, we made it a point in the National Security Council that our primary parameters should not only be on the financial capability of the company that will come in, but more importantly, the internet speed as well as the population coverage. That is not to say, though, that the financial capability is not important. We made a distribution of points to the internet speed, to the population coverage, and to the financial capability. And indeed, we came up with what we call the highest committed level of service, or HCLOS model, to be used for selecting the NMP. Being the National Security Advisor, it is my responsibility to ensure that the NMP will not pose a national security risk. This is aligned with the national security policy and national security strategy. Cybersecurity, which the NMP will have to deal with, since it will provide internet connection to its subscribers, is part of the 12-point national security agenda. Promoting a safe and secure cyberspace is part of the functions of national security, which the NSC is responsible for. That is why the Oversight Committee included a clause stating that the NMP's networks and facilities should not compromise national security, and this is found in Section 10.1F4 of the memo circular. As planned under the selection procedure, the NMP is obliged to submit this assurance as part of its requirements. As to the background of the companies that will participate in the third telco, we have asked the National Intelligence Coordinating Agency to conduct a background check on the four companies that will comprise the third telco, Mislatel Group. The report will be submitted within the month. We are aware of the risks of any telco that can come in, as there are such things as capabilities to geolocate all subscribers, meaning the company can locate you if you have your phone, as is what is happening now, whether you are with Smart or Globe. It is also manifested in such applications as Waze. They know where you are if you subscribe to such applications. There is also the risk of the transfer of data from the Philippines to a third location or to another country. There is also the risk of changing the protocol that is present in our telecommunications right now, which they call the SS7 protocol. And there is also the possibility of affecting our Philippine law enforcement and intelligence authorized interception capabilities. But we are now in the 2G frequencies. The third telco will not be awarded any 2G frequencies. Aware of these risks, we will situate that appropriate measures will be inputted in the final awarding of the telco post qualification. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
Secretary Esperon, what particular measures are you proposing to ensure our security? You said that appropriate measures will be done, but give me an example if you can reveal that.
It's largely technical. That's why we have the cyber. We have the implementing agency or the supervising agencies in the personalities of NTC and DICT. And it has something to do with the
intelligence platform.
It has something to do with our cybersecurity intelligence platform, which is now being implemented.
Pero di ba sinabi din ninyo na you will complete the background check, iimbestigan pa ninyo yung background ng kumpanya. So hindi pa tapos.
Yes, but these are listed companies, and so we do not want to make any comments on that yet because it has not been completed. But the sources are open sources, mostly SEC.
SEC.
PhilHealth, and mostly open sources. So they will all be there to be submitted to NTC at the appropriate time.
We would like to ask for a copy of your findings when you have completed the vetting process, sir.
We will do that.
Okay, thank you, General Esperon. I would like to ask now Mr. Dennis Uy if you have any opening statements, sir.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Please allow me to read my opening statement and updates on the third telco. Good morning, Madam Chair, members of this honorable committee. Salamat po sa invitasyon sa akin bilang isang resource person sa pagdinig ng committee ukol sa issues on the third telco. Una po sa lahat, humihingi po ako ng paumanhin na hindi ako naka-attend sa last hearing dahil out of town po ako attending an official event. Nandito po ako ngayon together with my with our General Counsel, Attorney Adel Tamano, and General Rodolfo Santiago, Head of our Technical Team of Ms. Latel, para makapagbigay ng informasyon, technical and legal matters which are among the concerns of the Honorable Committee, specifically sa national and cybersecurity issues para sa kaalaman at kapakanan ng publiko. On General Santiago, he has more than 38 years of military experience and training, specializing in military communication, security, intelligence, particularly technical intelligence. Your Honors, matagalin tayo maghintay para sa isang well-tracked and affordable telecommunications provider. Kung kaya kumisip namin na uroon ang ginawa ng Thank you.
alternatibo na tinatawag nating duopoly sa telekomunikasyon. Humility aside, we just don't want to be just the third telco. We want to be the best telco, a telco that is fast, affordable, and most importantly, secure. Kung may isang bagay po akong kayang panghawakan, ang proyekteng ito ay dumaan sa pinakamahigpit na pagsusuri na kahit ano ako po bilang isang negosyante ni minsan ay hindi pinagdaanan. Aaminin ko po na marami akong kaibigan at advisors, even my family, na nagsasabi na huwag na po ako pumasok sa ditong sa telecommunications dahil napakaraming sakripisyo ang kailangan bago kami makaramdam ng kahit konting kita. Ngunit pinili kong magpursige dahil naniniwala ako na kailangan ito para sa mabilis na pag-unlad ng Pilipinas. Marami rin po kaming mga batikos na narinig, mga bintang na walang batayan. Ngunit hindi kami mawalan ng loob dahil alam namin na wala kaming nilabag na batas. Dumaan kami sa tama at mahabang proseso at higit sa lahat, malinis ang aming pangalan kahit anumang industriya o negosyo na aming pinasukan. Ang hiling namin sa komite, sa mga stakeholders sa industriya, sa publiko, magtulungan tayo. Let's work together to achieve a world-class telecommunications to empower Filipinos and build the nation. Finally, as an update, Madam Chairperson, I am honored to personally submit to this committee advanced copy of Ms. Latell's rollout plan containing the cybersecurity plan that details how we intend to achieve our commitments and protect national security. Muli, maraming salamat po.
If your honors please, may Mr. Uy submit the advance copy to your honors.
Yes, we will appreciate a copy of that from Ms. Latell. Thank you for your opening statement, Mr. Uy. Are you also going to present?
No, your honors. We'd like to physically
just
provide it.
Okay. Yeah, please. Oh, you can just ask the secretary. Give it to. Thank you. Perhaps we can hear from Mr. Santiago. Bigyan mo kami ng kahit na maikling paliwanag tungkol sa inyong rollout plan, lalo kasama na yung seguridad ng ating bansa.
Madam Chair, magandang umaga po. Tututok po ako dun sa National Cybersecurity Plan na bahagi po ng aming rollout plan. At katulad po ng ibang mga malalaking telecommunications company, apat po ang pillars upang ang seguridad ng aming network ay ma-assure. And this would include network security, the operations and maintenance security, the individual private data security, at ang kahuli-hulihan po ay ang emergency response dahil sa aming pong belief wala pong anumang security na hindi kayang pasukin ng kahit sino. Ibig pong sabihin, there is no impenetrable barrier. And that's why kung mangyari po ito, mayroon po kaming pillar that would address whatever intrusion, whatever threat our network would suffer and react accordingly. Maraming pong salamat.
Siguro ang paliwanag na napaka-technical ay maaari namang isumite na lang sa amin. Sapagkat, syempre, ang pagpapatibay ng seguridad natin ay maraming mga iba't ibang bagay na dapat gawin, di ba? May mga eksperto naman siguro dyan, kasama ninyo, na tutulong sa inyo.
Opo, Madam Chair. At for the information of the committee po, I have been collaborating with the government agencies na nag-assure na kailangan ang national security at national interest po ay maprotektahan natin. I've been in close coordination with the ICT, NTC, the NSA, and even the Armed Forces of the Philippines upang sa tulong po nila ay ma-assure namin na hindi magiging sagabal o balakid ang third telco sa ating national security.
Maraming salamat. Gaya nga na nabanggit ni Mr. Uy, talagang kailangan natin ng mas mabilis at mas magaling na serbisyo sa ating bansa. Maraming salamat doon sa mga namumuhunan dito sa atin. Pero siyempre, kagaya nga ng napaka-importanteng bagay na ito, ito'y ating binubusisi para walang sisihan sa dulo na hindi natin ginampanan ang ating trabaho. So, the chair would like to acknowledge Senator Drilon now for his questions.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, this is the first time that I'm attending this committee hearing. I understand this is the third one. I'll ask some basic questions, which, if already answered in the previous hearings, I would appreciate the chair just advising me, and we can just ask the technical staff what were the responses in to these questions. As I said, I'll ask certain basic questions, principally as a lawyer and as a legislator. All these technical things sound so Greek to me, so I will not go into that. But just certain basic data that I wish. Who can respond for Mindanao Islamic Telephone Company or Ms. Latell? Who can answer questions for the company, Madam Chair?
Thank you. We have, well, Mr. Uy, Attorney Tamano, and General Santiago.
Okay, yes. When was Ms. Latell or Ms. Latell incorporated?
If Your Honor, please, Mr. Nick Escalante, who is the original owner of Ms. Latell, is here. In regard questions on earlier ownership, he may be the proper person to
the first,
answer that,
yes.
Your Honors.
So, anyone, that's why I was asking who can respond for Ms. Latell. So, who can respond for Ms. Latell?
Mr. Nick Escalante, Your Honors. He was also given an invitation by this Honorable Committee.
Okay. Mr. Escalante. Are you an incorporator in the original corporation when the Ms. Latell was incorporated? Are you? I don't see your name.
Good morning, Your Honors. Yeah, to answer the question, I am not an incorporator, Your Honor.
You are not there. Yeah. So who? Okay. But you are presently.
I am a present stockholder of Ms. Latell, Your Honor.
You are a present stockholder of Ms. Latell. You are Mr. Nicanor Escalante.
That's my name, Your Honor.
Yeah. And if my records are correct, can you confirm that you own about 11.67% of Ms. Latell?
Yes, Your Honor.
When did you acquire these shares? My record shows that you acquired that you have something like 5,834,334 shares. When did you acquire these shares?
If my recollection is correct, Your Honor, it was sometime 2015.
2015. Okay. What about Mr. Danilo Cortez? He also invested about 5.8 million pesos, just rounded off. That's also about 11.67%. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor. We came into Ms. Latell together.
So 2015 also.
2015, Your Honor.
And Mr. Toquero? What's your
question? Yes, Your Honor.
Also 11.67%?
Yes, Your Honor.
And this is also in 2015?
Yes, Your Honor.
Who is, and then there's another corporation here, CTE Vector Holdings, also 35%. Who is this?
That company, Your Honor, is owned wholly by the three of us, the names you mentioned, Your Honor.
CTE.
Yes. Yes, Your Honor.
This is CTE is Cortez
Toquero Escalante.
And you purchased 35%.
Yes, Your Honor.
Also in 2015.
Correct, Your Honor.
So, okay. So the three of you, yourself, Danilo Ortez, and Mr. Toquero, acquired about, my calculation, 70% of Ms. Latel.
Yes, Your Honor. We were invited by the then incumbent owners to join them and participate in the operation of the company.
So the incumbent owners had only 30% left after you came in?
Something like that, Your Honor.
More or less, yeah, because you're fortunate. So you have full control now of Ms. Latel.
Yes, Your Honor.
Starting 2015. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Now, have you secured congressional approval of this transfer of control from the existing stockholders to you, to your group?
We did not, Your Honor.
You did not secure congressional approval?
No.
You did not secure, and up to this date, as we are talking, you have not secured any congressional approval.
No, Your Honor, on the ground that we were just entering as additional shareholders.
That's right. Because you are just entering as additional stockholders, you did not feel that you should secure congressional approval. Is that correct? Is that your opinion?
Yes, Your Honor.
You are aware of Section 15 of the franchise of Ms. Latel?
I'm not very familiar with that, Your Honor.
Let me read it to you for the record. Section 15 of the franchise of Ms. Latel reads, Section 15, sale, lease, transfer, usufruct, etc. The grantee, which is Ms. Latel, shall not lease, transfer, grant the usufruct of, sell, nor assign any of this franchise or the rights or privileges acquired thereunder to any person, firm, company, corporation, or other commercial or legal entity, nor merge with any corporation or entity, nor shall the controlling interest of the grantee be transferred, whether as a whole or in part, and whether simultaneously or contemporaneously to any person, firm, company, corporation, or entity without the prior approval of the Congress of the Philippines. Any person or entity to which this franchise is sold, transferred, or assigned shall be subject to the same conditions, its limitations, terms, restrictions, and limitations of this act. So, were you aware of this?
We seek legal opinion from a lawyer, and he said since we were not acquiring the then existing shares of the incumbent shareholders, we were allowed to do that, Your Honor.
I see. May we know who your counsel is, if that is not confidential?
Well, I don't remember his name right now, Your Honor.
I don't. This is only recently. This is 2015, barely 3 years ago. So we are wondering, because we want to test the theory of this lawyer. It is very clear, and you need not be a lawyer to understand that when you transfer controlling interest of the franchise holder of the grantee, you must secure the approval of Congress. And let me tell you why. When a franchise is issued, Congress would look at the qualifications of the stockholders or the controlling interest. That's basic. In other words, not every, this is a privilege, and therefore we must look at the background of the grantee and the stockholders to determine that the privilege granted by the state can be exercised correctly and faithfully. That is why, apart when the franchise is granted, we go through hearings like this and examine this the prospective grantee. That same reasoning will apply when the control is transferred to another entity. And that is why clearly under Section 15 of the franchise granted to Ms. Latell, you are supposed to have secured the prior approval of Congress. This was done in this, you acquired 70% of Ms. Latell. That means a supermajority. You can, with 66 and two-thirds control of the corporation, you can do everything. Sell the assets, everything. Now, you are now in control of the Ms. Latell. The Congress had no opportunity to examine your capability, sir, to exercise the rights under this franchise. That is why the Section 15 is the reason why we are having this kind of hearings to determine the capability of the franchise holder. This is a serious issue. You know, stop laughing at smiling. You know, this is a serious issue.
I'm sorry,
and you sound look as if you know the, you are taking this for granted. Huwag niyo po akong hingitian nang at nasa seryoso po itong usapang ito.
Sorry, Your Honor.
Huh? Nakaka-insulto po kayo. So again, I repeat. What do you think? So, Ms. Madam Chair, it turns out that the control of Ms. Latell was 70% was controlled or was transferred to the group of Mr. Escalante without appropriate congressional approval. And under the very terms of the franchise, the transfer of this control is void because of the lack of congressional approval.
Senator Drilon,
yes.
Let me also ask the background of Mr. Escalante. Sinasabi po ninyo na hindi kayo masyadong na kayo ay pinayuhan ng inyong abogado na hindi din kayo kailangan dumaan sa Kongreso. Bago po yan, ano po ba ang kabuhayan ninyo? Dati po ay meron kayong concessionaire kayo dito sa Senado dati, ano? Ng catering?
Huh? Yung anak ko po yon.
Yung anak? Hindi. Pero...
Catering?
Opo. Anak nyo, hindi kayo? Pero
hindi,
kilala po kayo ng mga nagtatrabaho dito?
Namamasyal lang po doon.
Ah. Okay, so hindi kayo nakapagtanong sa amin.
No,
nag-apply kayo ng prangkisa.
No, that was 2017, I think, Your Honor.
So nag-apply po kayo ng prangkisa para magkaroon nga kayo nitong kapabilidad na ng telco. Pero ano pong background ninyo? Bakit po kayo nag-apply at naging operational po ba kayo?
Unang-una, Your Honor, when we acquired Ms. Latell 2015 up to now, there was no actual operation of the company.
But your franchise was granted to you what year? Yung sa inyo?
Well,
ano ang pangalan ng kumpanya ninyo bago Ms.
Hindi ho. Ang nangyari, we did not acquire the company. We just came in as additional shareholders.
No, 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 you're a franchisor.
You are controlling, you acquired 70% of Ms. Latel.
No, we came in individually, Your Honor.
Yes, all right. Joint venture, the three of you, controls 30% or 35%. And then you control in your personal capacity 11%. And your two other partners control 22%, or a total of 70%. How do you now justify to us this patent violation of your franchise? You know, we have this committee, a number of franchises controlling interests were transferred, and we had to approve it. There are a number of corporations who came to us. By the way, what is your background here? This is the problem. You acquired controlling interest on a corporation, granted the privilege of a franchise. That is why we must know the background of the stockholders. That is why, as a standard provision in all the franchises granted by this committee, is the requirement that the transfer must be approved by Congress, because we want to inquire into the background of the person given this privilege. And here we had no opportunity to examine this because you did not come to us to seek our approval, or I mean, we say we mean Congress. The chair asked you whether you have connection with our catering services here in the Senate, and you said the catering services here is part of is your family business or something.
Yeah, it was my daughter and wife, Your Honor.
So it is your family business?
In a way, but I was not formally part of it.
That's why you said your family. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yes.
So your family is involved in the catering business here in this island?
That was about 2 years ago, Your Honor. They are not here anymore.
Yes, 2 years ago. But 2 years prior to that, you acquired majority control of Ms. Latel.
Yes, Your Honor.
And how much was the investment?
Around 5 million, Your Honor, as you mentioned earlier.
Five? Are you sure? Five? How much? 5 million? Yours is 5.8 million, rounded off. Mr. Cortez had 5.8 million rounded off. Mr. Toquero had 5.8 million rounded off. And your joint venture CTE Vector Holdings at 17.5 million. So it's at 5 million. Madam Chair, I'm sorry. But this resource person has not been placed under oath. That's why he's taking liberties with his answers.
That's right. I don't think, he wasn't here yet.
No,
he administered.
Have you taken your oath?
I took my oath during the last hearing.
Okay.
Your
Honor. All right. I'm sorry.
Okay, yeah, we received
it
anyway.
How much was your investment? At least you and your partner, so quite 70%. Is it about 35 billion?
Sir, pati hindi po ninyo matandaan yung investment ninyo. Napaka-importante po nun. At hindi po maliit na halaga.
Out of a total, correct me if I'm wrong, I'm looking at raw data here. Out of a total amount of subscription of 50 million, you had 35 million.
32 million.
32 billion. So that's clearly almost 70%. Is that correct?
I think so, Your Honor.
So you have full control of Ms. Latel right now?
Well, in the existing board, there are three of us, two from the original incorporators or shareholders, Your Honor.
So there are five members of the board of directors?
As it is right now, Your Honor.
As it is right now. And two are from the original?
Yes, Your Honor.
And three from your group?
Yes, but yeah, that's correct, Your Honor.
Which means that precisely all we were saying from the very start, you control about 70%, a little less than 70%. That is why you have three members of the board of Ms. Latel.
Well, it's not absolute control, Your Honor. Three.
Never mind.
Yeah.
Okay, so whether it's absolute control or less than absolute control, you have control. Is that correct?
It's Your Honor.
And you did not seek congressional approval for acquiring control, contrary to the franchise stipulation of Ms. Latel.
Yes, Your Honor.
When was your last board meeting of Ms. Latel?
I think that was before the bidding for the third telco, Your Honor.
So when was that approximately?
That was, I think, late October, Your Honor.
Late October of 2018. And after that, you did not meet anymore.
No further meeting after that, Your Honor.
Under your bylaws, how regular should your meetings be?
The annual meeting is, of course, just once, and
that is a stockholders meeting. I'm talking about the board of directors.
The board only when there is a necessity to meet, Your Honor.
Only when necessary.
Yes, Your Honor.
And in 2018, you met once only, to your recollection?
I think once or two times, Your Honor.
Once or two times. So Ms. Latel is basically a paper corporation. You are not in operation.
We are not in operation, Your Honor, but we were in the process of applying for a provisional authority for a nationwide broadband.
I see.
And in addition, we were already able to acquire.
So you are not in operation?
No operation yet.
You are not in operation. You. Under the franchise of Ms. Latel, you are supposed to commence operating within 1 year from the approval of Ms. Latel. Do you recall that?
1998, I believe, was when you first acquired the franchise.
Ms. Latel was incorporated on April, was granted the franchise on April 19, 1998. So that within 1 year, you must commence operations. That's the provision of your of the Ms. Latel's franchise.
Of course, I was not yet in the company, Your Honors,
yes.
But our records show that sometime 2001, Ms. Latel was issued a provisional authority for a local exchange in Parang, Maguindanao.
Okay. So you have you gotten a certificate of public convenience and necessity?
Just a PA, Your Honor.
Huh?
Provisional authority, Your Honor.
Not CPCN?
No, Your
you
Honor.
You have no CPCN?
No, Your Honor.
So, you have not operated continuously or commenced operations within 3 years, as required by your franchise, within 3 years from the approval of your franchise.
No,
not to your knowledge, because you were not there.
Yeah, but the company was ready to roll out in Parang Maguindanao in 2003, according to our records. But the peace and order situation in that area, in Parang Maguindanao, did not allow the company to operate.
I see. So really, because of the peace and order situation, you were not able to operate?
Yes, Your Honor.
Unfortunate, but you could have operated somewhere else. The franchise would allow you to have done that.
I think so, Your Honor.
Yes, you would have operated somewhere else, but you did not operate.
They did not operate somewhere else, Your Honor. They simply...
Under Section 7 of the franchise granted to you, the franchise is deemed ipso facto revoked if you fail to comply with these conditions. Do you realize that?
Yeah, that's what it says in the provision, Your Honor.
So, if it is so, you would agree with me that the franchise of Ms. Ratel is deemed revoked for your failure to comply with the conditions imposed on the franchise?
I think when Ms. Ratel was given the opportunity to explain to NTC, they gave the justification for the non-operation on the peace and order problem, which to them was a force majeure, Your Honor.
But your franchise would have allowed you to operate somewhere else, and the explanation should be done to Congress, not anywhere else, because it is Congress who granted you the franchise. In any case, it is clear that you have not started operations.
Yes, Your Honor.
All right. So, I submit that to the committee chair for its consideration, because a valid franchise is a requirement under the NTC guidelines. That's a qualification imposed by the NTC. And here you have a situation where there is no existing franchise anymore because of the violations of the grantee of the conditions imposed in the franchise. So this is a, because they did not operate the franchise in violation of the terms of the franchise, and there was no congressional approval for the transfer of the controlling interest. This is a question which must be resolved, because under the NTC guidelines, a valid franchise is a requisite. There is no valid franchise in the view of this representation. So that must be considered, and we hope that the NTC can, respond to that legal situation. For the meantime, but this, we strongly submit that this matter be resolved, because this is basic. This is very basic. We are following the guidelines of the NTC, which says that there must be a valid and existing franchise, and it is very clear that Ms. Ratel's franchise, at the very least, is of doubtful validity as we talk today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The chair recognizes the observation of our minority leader, and in fact shares also certain concerns about that, because I think that the reason they were able to reach this point, Senator Drilon, is because of the interpretation of the lower house, that they may have violated, but it's for the courts to decide if they are, if their franchise is still valid or not, which I think this representation strongly disagrees with, and we need to be able to clarify the law and make it clear, at least for future franchises, that the decision must really come from the legislative branch with regards to franchises.
Madam Chair, I agree with the interpretation of the Chair. The one who determines whether the franchise is being complied with is the one who granted the franchise. In this case, Congress. It is not for the court to determine, it is not only the court who will determine, but since these are the conditions of the franchise that we granted, we can always pass a resolution which says that the franchise is hereby revoked. This is a privilege granted, and therefore the privilege can be revoked by the one who granted that privilege, in this case, Congress. That does not deprive the court of the jurisdiction, but to review the franchise, as may be stated by the House, but there is nothing that will prevent us from revoking the franchise or by the terms of the franchise. It is ipso facto void, meaning you even don't need any action because it is ipso facto revoked by the wording of the franchise. If it's ipso facto revoked, that means you don't need any action. It is just revoked. So this is an issue which must be resolved, Madam Chair.
Before I give the floor to Senator Trillanes, I see Secretary Rio raising his hand. Do you have a
Yes, Madam. Just to be clear, the terms of reference especially look into this issue, no? And basically, what we did was these are all going to be part of the post-qualification. Because if we put this in the pre-qualification, imagine, Madam Chair, if we have to require all those who would like to enter the bidding, okay, you get all the necessary requirements for coming up with your organization. Then if they lose, what will they do with all those organizations? So, in fact, we said, if you win, you will have to undergo a post-qualification process, which includes precisely what is being taken up now.
Paano yan, Secretary Rio, kung nag-desisyon ng Kongreso na revoke yung franchise, disqualify sila, umpisa na naman tayo?
That's true, Madam. Yes. That's in the terms of reference. If you do not pass the post-qualification, you will not be given any...
No. With all due respect to Secretary Rio, if you do not have the qualification, you cannot participate. That is a pre-qualification requirement, a valid franchise. This is not a post-qualification requirement. Here in this case, it would appear that they transferred control 3 years ago, 4 years ago. Up to this time, there is not even an attempt to secure congressional approval, and under the terms of the franchise is ipso facto revoked. So, to me, it is not a post-qualification. It's a pre-qualification requirement.
Yes, Your Honor. Actually, we did some due diligence before to get the qualification, the list, because it simply states that you must have a valid franchise, no? And all of those who participated made presentation that they have a valid franchise. And we did also some checking.
No, with the facts now coming out that apparently they, that it's clear that they failed to secure congressional approval in the transfer of control and they have not operated. Yeah. Would this affect the qualification of Ms. Latell?
Precisely, Your Honor.
What do you mean precisely?
We have protected the government by not giving out anything for them to perform as a telco until they pass all requirements.
A pre-qualification, a pre-bidding requirement, must that the bidder must have the qualification. And the qualification is that a congressional franchise holder. In this particular case, there is a question as to the validity of the franchise for two very basic violations.
If I may explain, Your
yes,
Honor,
yes,
we
please.
Were under time pressure to come up with a third term. So what we did was You have to take the risk, no, in the post-qualification.
I'm sorry, but the, well, the time pressure is not a, a justification for violating your own guidelines, and you didn't, and this was not even brought up, you know. So anyway, I'm submitting this as for the consideration of the committee, Madam Chair.
Secretary Liosi, I understand the pressures of work. On the other hand, if we don't do our work accordingly or properly, it causes undue delay also. I mean, I'd like this to succeed because gusto ko talaga na magkaroon ng mas magandang serbisyo ang ating mga kababayan. Kung pinapangako na nila yan at may capital sila, bakit naman hindi? Kaya lamang, hindi na naman natin pwedeng baliwalain ang batas natin. So, yun ang magiging problema natin kung hindi natin inayos ang ating proseso. Attorney Tamano and then Senator Trillanes.
Thank you, Madam Senator. Just very briefly, and this is in no way disagreeing with the Honorable Senator Drilon, but perhaps we can submit also for the consideration of this Honorable Committee a decision by the Supreme Court, specifically in the case of PLDT versus NTC, GR number 88404. If you take a look at that case, Your Honors, please, and we will submit a copy of this decision. It is almost in all fours with the current situation of Ms. Latell, Your Honors. A question was raised at that time by PLDT in regard the franchise of ETCI, and they were claiming similarly that they did not comply with the franchise requirements, etc. The Supreme Court made a very simple decision here, Your Honors, please, that since a franchise is a property right, there is a due process requirement for it to be revoked, and a direct action for quo warranto is the proper action to take. So until such direct action is undertaken by the state, collateral attacks on a franchise are not permitted. We will submit this this case to the Honorable Committee for your considerations, Your Honors. Thank you.
Madam Chair, I will not debate with my good friend, Attorney Tamano, but we will await that submission. But just one point. A franchise is a privilege. The privilege has conditions. Among the conditions is that you must operate within 1 year, and operate continuously. Number two, you must seek the approval of Congress where you cede control. Those are the terms of the privilege. That is why when you violate these conditions, the privilege, which is in the form of the franchise, is ipso facto revoked. As I said, we will not bore our audience with a debate on a legal matter, but we will eagerly await your submission, Attorney Tamano. Thank you, Madam Chair.
I think, Senator Drilon, you being a lawyer, shouldn't they have also offered to the public ownership through a stock offering? That isn't that part also of the requirement for a franchise? And I don't think they've done so when they first have their franchise.
It is a dispersal requirement. Under section 16, if I'm not mistaken, in accordance with constitutional provisions to encourage public participation in public utilities, the grantee shall offer at least 30% of its outstanding capital stock, or a higher percentage as we provided by law, in any securities exchange in the Philippines within 5 years from the commencement of its operations. You're correct, Madam Chair.
Yes, I believe they didn't comply with that requirement within that 5 years, if I'm not mistaken. So this is something that they also need to submit to the body.
So we will eagerly await the submission of Ms. Latell on this. Is Attorney Tamano also the counsel of Ms. Latell?
Yes, Your Honor, I'm the general counsel.
You are not the one who rendered that opinion.
No, that was
because
not
I would have been disappointed if you rendered that opinion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Paul.
Senator Trillanes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just on the point that Senator Drilon was pursuing, In addition to the violations of Section 7, Section 15, and Section 16, yung sinasabi nila na may case decided on by the Supreme Court, pero yung NTC, the government entity that's supposed to implement the law, dapat on its face, hindi na nakalusot sa pre-qualification. Then, yung sinasabi ni Attorney Tamano na decision ng Supreme Court, ihabol nyo yan sa korte. It's not assumed. Dahil dito, as we can see, no October 2018, 10 franchise holders ang bumili ng bidding documents. So kung mawala man yung Ms. Latel, you still have 9. And yet dito, nung the day na nagbidding, hinigpitan nyo yung dalawang kakompetensya ng Ms. Latel. You were so liberal in allowing Ms. Latel to join despite all the violations cited by Senator De Leon. And yet dito, sa bidding itself, hinigpitan nyo. Anyway, yan yung unang himala dito sa proseso na to. And mapapaliwanagan ang mga kababayan natin as we go along kung bakit nga pinapalusot itong Ms. Latel na ito. Now, Madam Chair, I'll go to Mr. Dennis Uy. Kailan mo, do you have any background on managing a telecom company?
Professionally po, no po.
No, okay.
But I'm a businessman, so I can
yes
also learn in no time.
So, kailan mo naisip mag-engage dito sa telecom business na ito?
I think sometime late last year. When
late last year?
November, when the okay president announced.
So, nagko-coincide dun sa time na naghahanap
mo? No, 2017 po.
2017, sorry. Okay. 2019. So itong pag-acquire mo ng Ms. Latel, kailan ito nangyari?
20 we did not acquire it because we need the approval, no? But we've been talking since 2018 po.
So what is your personality here right now?
The binding we're the owner of the binding bidding document, the winning bidder for the NMP po.
So, wala kang, unless the sale is approved by Congress, wala kang personality dito. So, mawawala rin yung, so you're representing yeah Udena? Or, yes. What's that?
Yes, po.
So, you're here as what?
I'm here as, I was invited by the Honorable Senator Grace po. And
no,
represented the Udena Corp.
No, but when the chairman was asking who will represent Ms. Latel, you were saying that you were representing Ms. Latel.
Yes, because after the approval of the change of franchise, we will be the one who control Ms.
No, Latel. No, but that has yet to happen. So you don't have any personality here. Is that what you're saying?
I'm just representing a corporation as a consortium partner.
Consortium partner of Ms. Latel.
Yes, po.
But is there any congressional approval for that acquisition?
That's why we're all here.
So that's the point. Ngayon, nakita nyo, Secretary Rio, sir, napaka-komplikado ng sitwasyon ng Ms. Latel. And there are other bidders. But how come doon sila tinutuloy? Remember, yung bang Ms. Latel, nag-operate sila even for a day as a telecom company? Kasi nag-aspire kayo, I heard your speech earlier, Mr. Uy, that you're aspiring to be the best telco. And sabi mo, wala kang experience, and Ms. Latel itself, the company that you're acquiring, walang experience, at least in the Philippine setting. So, paano ngayon yun? Kumbaga, it doesn't connect, Secretary Rio. And ito nga, so anyway, wala ka pang personality. Ngayon, before approaching Ms. Latel, did you approach any other telco to be a platform for this, this, or before you entered into this bidding?
We have options for the NTC. They have accredited over 30 franchises valid to be eligible to be part of the bidding process.
So,
and being from Mindanao and being Attorney Tangano, part of Islam, we were able to, well, Ms. Latel and us were able to strike an agreement that we joined forces and bid for it. On the matter of no experience, po, I think our partners have the technical experience, China Telecom, to be able to deliver the promises. I think all businesses, po, as a businessman, I think we are well capable in due time to be able to learn and compete in the telco. Hindi naman ibig sabihin, wala tayong experience. Yeah. Hindi tayo pwede makalaban sa isang sektor. Napaka-unfair naman po.
Naiintindihan ko yun. Naiintindihan ko po yun, but this is a highly technical field. Hindi pwedeng a group of businessmen lang will just suddenly aspire to be that third telco without any background at all. Now, you partnered with a local company that has a franchise which never operated even for a single day as a telco. Yes. So, wala rin experience yon. Ngayon, ang dinadrive ko rito, naghahanap ka before ng Ms. Latel, meron kang nilapitan na ibang company. Anong company pa yung mga nilapitan mo?
I think
to offer we have the same
halos,
thing.
Halos lahat po. They were offering their franchise to part of the as to be part of the consortium.
Okay.
And we have also engaged law firms, lawyers to do our due diligence, full due diligence po. And,
okay.
So before we submitted, because we don't want to be remiss in our obligation and in following the criteria of the bidding process.
Okay. Yeah. Ganito. There's that certain level of confidence sa'yo na somehow you will get it. Na somehow you will get this franchise. And let me show the public how. No? Are you close to President Duterte?
No.
Well, no, you're not?
I'm from Davao and I'm...
Are you close to him or not?
Yes.
Yes, you're close to him. Are you close to Mr. Bongo?
Opo.
Yes, okay. Nag-contribute ka ng sa campaign ni Mr. Duterte?
Yes po, at nag-contribute po ako sa
okay.
Iba.
Okay, how much?
As declared po, I think contributed 30 million.
As declared, 30 million. Yung bang mga officers and board of directors ng UDENA ay nag-contribute din kay Mr. Duterte?
Hindi po.
Hindi. Are you sure? May listahan ako rito.
I don't know po.
May nakasulat dito si Miss Sherilyn Uy, your wife.
Mm-hmm.
Nag treasurer siya ng UDENA. Nag-contribute ba siya kay Mr. Duterte or not?
I think so po.
Yes. So yung initial statement mo na
sorry
hindi.
Po. I don't memorize po.
Okay, don't memorize.
Yeah.
Pero tinanong kita kung yung mga officers and board of directors mo ba ay nag-contribute din kay Mr. Duterte. Sabi mo, no. Okay.
I'm not sure.
You're not sure. Okay. You know Mr. Efren Uy?
Yes, po.
Yes. Who is he? And how is he related to you?
No, he's my business partner.
Business and, partner.
Distant relative.
Okay. Board member siya ng Chelsea Logistics.
Mm-hmm.
Nag-contribute siya kay Mr. Duterte ng 3.5 million. Etong si Chris Alfonsus Damoy. Kilala mo siya?
Mm-hmm.
You know him? So ano siya?
He's the president of our Chelsea Logistics.
Okay, president. Ano. Mm-hmm. Nag-contribute din siya kay Mr. Duterte. Si Maria Henedina San Juan. You know her?
She's our corporate secretary.
Okay. So nag-contribute din siya kay Mr. Duterte. So si Miss Ignacia Braga. You know her?
Yeah, she's the CFO.
Oh, CFO. Nag-contribute din siya kay Mr. Duterte. So marami nag-contribute kay Mr. Duterte. You know Mr. Paul Dominguez?
Yes, po.
Yes. Ano siya?
He used to be our director, po.
He used to be a director of Phoenix.
Yes, po.
Okay. How is he related to the finance secretary?
They're brothers, po.
Brothers. Si Secretary Dominguez ba ay member ng Oversight Committee?
Yes, I think.
Yes. Uh-huh. Okay. So, kaibigan mo si Bongo, si Duterte, kaibigan mo, yung kapatid ng Secretary of Finance na member ng Oversight Committee, dati mong member ng Board of Directors, yung officers and Board of Directors mo, ay nag-contribute kay Mr. Duterte. So, ano ito? Medyo lumiliwanag yung pagkaluto rito, ano? May ano ka ba? Do you own a private jet? Cessna Citation XLS.
No, I'm the part owner po.
Part owner. So you own. So at any one time, nakasama mo ba sa plane si Executive Secretary Medialdea, Secretary Dominguez, si Secretary Esperon, na mga members ng Oversight Committee sumakay dito sa plane mo. Let me just caution you that nakalagay yan sa passenger manifest. Okay? So, we'll give you the chance to tell the truth.
Yes.
Yes. So nakasama mo sila sa plane. Ito, ano to? Period ito ng 2018. So yung frequency niyan, makikita naman natin, ano? This time, around this time, when this third telco was at the peak nung pagpipili. Di ba? Okay. Next, even your house in Alpha Land, in Baguio, is frequented by Secretary Dominguez. Okay? Tapos, are you a presidential advisor of Mr. Duterte?
I'm a presidential advisor on sports.
Yes. So, alam nyo, on its face, marami na ako nakitang ano rito eh, mali. Whether conflict of interest, graft, indirect bribery. It's very clear now. Anyway, I'm presenting this to you, Secretary Rio, sir. I am still hoping that you'd have that objectivity. There's still time. And besides, wala pang approved transfer itong Ms. Latel. You can correct this. Dahil baka pag pinalalim ito, Secretary, ano tong mangyari ito nito, sir, eh? Baka i-apply sa inyo yung void ab initio. Di masasayang lahat ng efforts. Kasi nakita nyo, mga members ng Oversight Committee, kasama niya sa plane, at that time na pinipili itong third telco. Whereas, merong mga ibang aplikante, at least 10 players expressed interest na palagay ko wala namang ganong hassle. Na wala pang link diretso kay Mr. Duterte to avoid any hint na meron itong maniobra or preferential treatment. Kasi as it is, it's now oozing with preferential treatment and at worst, cronyism. And let me just cite kung gaano ka kaswerte ito si Mr. Dennis Uy as a businessman nung naupo si Mr. Duterte. He was able to get, you're a member of the board of directors ng Alpha Land ni Mr. Bobby Ongpin. Am I correct, Mr. Uy?
I was invited po.
Yes, but you are a member of the board. Okay. Pero itong si Mr. Bobby Ongpin, ito yung galit kunyari si Mr. Duterte, pinagmumura niya. Yung pala, nung pinagmumura niya, bumaba yung mga stocks ng PhilWeb, tapos nung mababa na, binili na nung mga kaibigan at eventually, inapprove din yung lisensya ng PhilWeb. Then, you're also a member ng board or you're a vice chairman ng isang mining company. Am I correct?
I'm not a vice chairman po.
Okay, member of the board ng Atok Big Wedge.
Yes, you know that? The director.
Okay, mining. Na kunyari, galit na galit si Mr. Duterte sa mining. Eh, yung pala, para lang makapasok yung mga, ano niya, kaibigan. Ngayon, meron ka bang casino franchise?
We have po.
You have. Saan?
We have one in Mactan, Cebu, and in Clark.
Okay. So, hindi totoo yung drama ni Mr. Duterte na galit siya sa casino. Ha? Huh? At nakapasok pala ang Davao Group. So, meron ka pang nakuha, what's that? Yung liquefied natural gas project? You were able to secure that?
We applied po and we were given a notice to proceed.
Okay, how much was that project?
And still now, we're still finalizing the investment number po. It's in the financial feasibility stage.
That was supposed to be a $2 billion project?
Estimated, and we, for the record po, we applied and we completed all the submission.
You applied and you competed at napili kayo just the same way na you applied dito at parang lumalabas na talagang lahat ng obstacles ay tinatanggal para mapaburan si Dennis Uy na kaibigan at campaign contributor ni Mr. Duterte at hindi lang yon at nung ibang mga senior cabinet officials na nagde-decide para pumili dito.
Yes. Senator Trillanes, we note your observations. I think the best solution to remove any speculation is just really to submit all of the necessary requirements that is due everyone. So, hindi po kasalanan na maging kaibigan ni Numan. Hindi rin po kasalanan na mamuhunan sa isang bagay, lalong-lalo na kung makakatulong ito sa ating mga kababayan. Pero syempre, hindi rin natin, lalong-lalo na napakahalaga ng issue na ito, kailangan mabura natin ang impresyon na merong kinilingan. So sa tingin ko naman, kung magko-comply sila dun sa requirements talaga, eh wala naman tayo din masasabi. Ito lang yung aking mga tanong siguro, no? Kasi nag-iingat din tayo dun sa kung sino ang nagbibigay ng kapital sa atin. Kasi kahit papano, baka yung utang na loob na yun doon ay manaig kesa dun sa mga iba pang obligasyon natin. Kasi po, noong 2008 to 2016, ang authorized capital ng UDENA ay naglalaro sa 600 million pesos at ang paid-up capital ay 120 million to 300 million. Pero noong 2018 po, 2 billion na po ang authorized paid-up capital or ang authorized capital at si Mr. Uy ay may 1.4 billion ang ipinasok. Pakipaliwanag lang po, kung paano ninyo nakuha yung ganito kalaking kapital,
Kasi ang sinasabi nila, may mga reports na ang pinakamalaking nagpautang dito ay ang Bank of China. So, dun po sa capital na nilagay niyo, Mr. Uy, saan po nang galing yung pera para palakihin ang investment dito sa Udena?
Madam Grace po, capital is really a function of retained earnings, debt, contribution of the members of the stockholders. And throughout the years, our businesses under Udena, we have different pillars, has grown and has contributed dividends. That's why bilang isang negosyante, we see that there's opportunity. Instead of just spending on the dividends, we chose to put back the dividends to the corporation for the corporation to grow.
So, ibig sabihin, dahil nga marami naman kayong mga iba't ibang kumpanya, mm-hmm. kung ano man yung kinita ninyo doon, yun ang naging puhunan ninyo para malagyan ng kapital itong
yes po.
Undertaking
that's correct
ito.
Po.
So, hindi and, naman galing sa China lahat nito.
Hindi po. Pero, wala po kapital galing sa China. Nangungutang na po tayo. Bank of China is a bank and all they do is just approve the loans. No?
So ngayon, dun sa China, wala namang sovereign guarantee na nakuha na pag pumalpak ito yung...
Wala po. This is a private endeavor po.
Pero magkano ang ilalagay nung partner ninyo na Chinese firm, if ever?
They're up to 40% po on 40%. Whatever investment.
So it's compliant with our laws anyway,
yes po.
Right?
And ako mismo, I don't want to break the law. I'm okay. A Filipino. What for?
And
yes.
Yes, you're... Yes. Definitely. And then... but I would like to ask, no? Kunyari, pumasa yung Public Services Act.
Mm-hmm.
Tapos pinayagan na natin yung dayuhan na may magmay-ari ng 60% or more. Are you inclined to give up control?
Depends on commercial agreements po. But if the law, I'm a businessman, if the law will allow it, then it's commercial. But... for sentimental reasons, for public interest, mahirap po, malayong mayari yun. So,
pero yun lang naman talaga, kasi pwede naman talaga ka na merong puhunan dito ang mga banyaga, ano, basta lamang ang seguridad natin yung manging ibabaw. So kung si General Santiago ay talagang tututukan itong privacy natin, eh wala namang masama na merong tumutulong. Pero gusto kong marinig yung Management Association of the Philippines. Sorry, Ms. Makasayat. Hindi, ano ba yung opinion ninyo dito sa mga pag-uusap natin?
Madam Chair, thank you. Sa business po, community, kami ay nababahala lang na napakatagal ng usapin ang extent ng problema ng business community sa internet, sa connectivity. So that's why we are here to listen to this and upon your invitation. So, ganun pa man, hanggang ngayon nga po, lalo pa rin nag-aalala ang mga negosyante kasi it is a big expense on the operations of business. And in fact, not only our customers are suffering from slow and expensive internet. So, we want a resolution na ipangako naman ng ating mga pinuno ng country natin. So, yun. Kailan kaya magkakaroon talaga ng solusyon? On top of that, our competitiveness, not only globally but even just among our Asian neighbors, ay masyado pong naapektuhan na dahilan sa connectivity issues. So, yun po ang tanong namin sa ating mga mababatas. Paano nga ba talaga ito masosolusyonan?
Mother,
Who wanted to speak?
Madam Chair. I just wanted
Secretary Esperon.
I just wanted to speak because my name was mentioned by... Oh, malis na pala si...
Hindi bali po. It's on the record naman. Yes, sir.
It was mentioned that I rode on a plane together with Executive Secretary and the Secretary Dominguez and... on a plane owned or partly owned by Mr. Dennis Uy. I am not sure when that was because the detail was not given. But the insinuation is that we were there because we were cooking up something. I just want to refute that because somehow, somewhere, amongst officials, we should also presume regularity of our acts. If I was riding that plane, were we talking about the telecoms, the third telecom? If it so happened that I am a member of the Oversight Committee, was I there because I was a member of the Oversight Committee, or I was simply going to Davao for official functions? In other words, I just want to say that if I was there, I'm not refuting it, because I go to Davao very often. And if there is a ride that will go there, because of time constraints, I might ride private planes. Will you fault me for that? My only interest here, as we all know, as the Management Association of the Philippines has been saying, is fast and efficient service. And so we drafted the terms of reference. In fact, I said in my opening remarks that I'm all for the highest committed level of service, meaning fast, efficient, and big coverage. And so, just like all of us here, ang gusto natin, yung, kung pwede nga sabihin, mura na, magaling pa, mabilis pa. So, by seeing me there in that plane, sa totoo lang, ang pumili na ng nag-screen ng mga papasok dito na third player ay ang National Telecoms Commission, which is not part of the Oversight Committee.
Actually, sir, I will go to that.
Yes. Ang sinasabi ko lang, Madam Chair.
Opo. No. I also agree
like
with that.
Na, ayoko naman depensahan si Mr. Oy. Pupunta ba tayo doon sa taga-Davao siya, napalapit siya sa isang mataas na opisyal? Yun lang ba ang rason kung bakit may negosyo siya? Nagsimula din naman sa ibang negosyo. I don't know how he started, but somehow he can do it. He can do things.
Hindi, alam mo, General Esperon, naiintindihan ko. Sapagat ang Pilipinas, kahit papano, nagkikita-kita tayo sa iba't ibang okasyon.
Yes. Okay.
Hindi naman nangangahulugan na meron tayong nilulutong hindi kanais-nais. No?
Yun lang po ang gusto kong sabihin na
opo.
Hindi porque nagkita-kita, sumakay sa isang aeroplano, ay may niluluto na kami.
Yeah,
for all I know, baka wala pa ako sa Oversight Committee nung sumakay ang
aeroplano. Madam Chair,
yes.
I think Secretary Esperon has responded sufficiently for the record. So may we go back to other questions,
yes,
which this representation.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Secretary Esperon.
Okay. I, as you mentioned, you're part of the Oversight Committee, right? And then, ang kasama po ninyo dito, oversight ba or selection?
Oversight Committee, Madam Chair.
Oversight. So, ikaw, kayo po?
Executive Secretary.
The Department of Finance.
DICT, and me, as the fourth member.
Pero yung selection committee sa NTC yon, di ba?
Oh, that's already
okay.
The selection.
Matanong ko po kayo, Chairperson Cordova. Kayo ang pumili nung, pinili ninyo yung selection committee na pipili nung kung sinong mananalo nitong third telco. Sino-sino po yung mga pinili ninyo, nakasama ninyo doon sa selection committee at bakit?
Your Honor, allow me to give a little background. Ano? Actually po, when we were doing the third telco bidding, as much as possible, we wanted it to be almost same format or aligned with the Republic Act 9184, which is the Procurement Act. Okay, under the Procurement Act po, ay meron pong HOPE, which is the head of the procuring agency, head of the procuring entity, so tinapat po namin yon sa NTC and Bank, which is composed of the commissioners and the two deputy commissioners. Sa 9184, meron pong tinatawag na BAC or Bids and Awards Committee. Ito naman po yung Selection Committee na binuo po namin. Meron din pong tumutulong sa Selection Committee na tinatawag pong Technical Working Group. So we also had that. At saka po, yun din pong pong tinatawag na Secretariat that helps all these entities na
pero kayo nga po ang pumipili.
Diba? Yes, Your Honor.
Ikaw lang mag-isa.
Hindi po. Pinirmahan po namin ng NTC and Bank, Your Honor. Yung pagpili
sino
po sa
kanila. Sino ba yung mga miyembro ng NBank? Ilan ba?
That would be the commissioner, ako po yun, and the two deputy commissioners, Your Honors.
So, kayong tatlo. So, sino itong si Ella Blanca Lopez?
Okay. Your Honors, based on Republic 19184, ang head po ng BAC should be the third highest ranking official in an office.
Okay.
So, si Attorney Ella Lopez is the head of our legal department. Director po siya sa legal department po namin.
Okay, sino naman si Teodoro Buenavista Jr.?
Okay, ko lang po si Attorney Ella Lopez. She is also part of the back of the office ng NTC, hindi po lang din sa third bidding, but also for all other matters.
Okay, okay. About Teodoro Buenavista?
Opo, Teodoro Buenavista, si Ted Buenavista po is a director ng amin pong regional office sa, I think, Region 10, Cagayan de Oro, Your Honors.
Saan ba siya yung pinili ninyo?
Actually po, Your Honors, because tinignan din po namin yung kanilang experience. Mm-hmm. Ano rin po siya, ma'am, member din siya ng BAC ng marami, and we can submit their qualifications. Makikita po ninyo, Your Honors.
Sino naman po si Alvin Bernardo Blanco?
Okay, Engineer Alvin Blanco is the head of our Broadcast Services Division.
Okay, so may opo, technical yes, siyang nalalaman.
Opo, yes, Your Honor.
Eh, sino naman si Samuel Sabile?
Okay, Sam Sabile is also an engineer. He's an ECE po. Siya po ang, marami po siyang pinagdaanan na offices sa amin, ano. He is also the NTC chair of the BAC. NTC BAC vice chair right now. So, kabisado rin po niya ang bidding. And he has been an ECE for 32 years. So, ano po, siya ang head po ng aming admin office po, Your Honors.
So, sino naman po si Andres Castellar Jr.?
Okay, Your Honors, Attorney Castellar is a lawyer in our office. He has been holding back positions in different government offices din po. Ganun din po, Your Honors. He's a lawyer. So, ano po ito, may mga kanya-kanya po silang expertise at we can submit their resume po at makikita po ninyo. Like, for example, si Ted Buenavista po has studied the management in public policy from the Lee Kuan Yew University, has been receiving honors and awards from different governing bodies. At yun din po yung halos lahat po ng members ng ano po.
So, ibig sabihin kahit na sabihin mo ng kaklase mo ang isa dito, may kakayanan naman dahil
yes, Your
kailangan
Honors.
Niyo na ng abogado.
Opo, Your Honors.
Ganon, okay. Siguro, I think that if there's a continuation, Senator Drilon will ask first, and then after which I would like to acknowledge the presence of our majority leader, Senator Meg Zubiri, will be asking after Senator Drilon. Thank you for clarifying.
Thank you, Your Honors.
Right, you've been watching the Philippine Senate hearing into the entry of the third telco player here in the Philippines, headed by the Senate Committee on Public Services, chaired by Senator Grace Poe. During the hearing, Senator Antonio Trillanes alleged that Davao-based businessman Dennis Uy was given preferential treatment in the selection of the country's third telco due to his ties to President Duterte and members of the Oversight Committee. Uy admitting that he contributed 30 million pesos to President Duterte's campaign. Now, in the middle of the grilling, Senator Grace Poe intervened, admitting or saying that it is not a sin to be friends with the president, and the best way to get to the bottom of things is to submit all the pertinent documents concerning the businesses of Mr. Dennis Uy. She asked, though, about how Mr. Uy was able to get the capital to expand his investment in Odena. To this, Mr. Uy said that he was able to raise capital through returned earnings, debt, and contributions of shareholders, insisting that it was a private endeavor and that China did not put any money into his business. Mr. Uy insisting that he did not break any law to win the bid for the country's third major telco player. We'll give you more details in our succeeding newscast. In the meantime, stay with ANC. Dateline Philippines is coming your way next.
To the player, that's what specifically does it mean? As I said, I'm not familiar with terminologies in this field. I just want to know, because you have used new major player as a category. Ano po bang ibig sabihin noon? Sabi mo to look for a third player, but my question is, does it grant any special privilege?
Actually, Your Honors, wala naman po. Talaga, ano lang po siya, dapat lang po siya pumasok sa market to be able to compete head-to-head with the two existing dominant players.
So, this is the first time
yes.
that this kind of a title is given to any player in the telecommunications industry. Is that correct?
That is correct, Your Honors.
There is no intention to grant them any preference?
Wala po, Your Honors.
How about in the bidding? There was no more bidding here, or was there a bidding?
There was a bidding, Your Honor.
On for what? For the?
Ano po, kapag ka po nagkaroon po ng bidding, yung po mananalo ay magkakaroon po ng frequencies that will be awarded to them that they can use to compete with the two existing players.
So it is for the,
yes,
grant of the frequency?
Yes, Your Honor.
So this new, major player is just a marketing tool? Is that what you understand it to be?
Hindi naman po. Parang naging ano lang po namin, naging tawag na lang po namin. There's no special...
Alam mo, when you use terminologies in law and you're a lawyer, there must be a meaning to it. You just cannot say the new major player and you project that... it is a privileged animal.
Actually, Your Honor, as I have mentioned earlier, ang treatment po namin doon would be the third player that can compete head-to-head to with the two dominant existing players.
By what authority under the law can you grant a crown to an entity and call him a new major player?
Your Honor, under the...
Wala kayo kapangyarihang gumawa ng ganong titulo.
Under the law po, Your Honors, we have the authority and the... authority to grant frequencies.
No question about that.
Yes,
authority
and
to grant
the Certificate of Public Convenience and Necessity.
Certificate of Public Convenience and Necessity. So the holder is a holder of the CPCN.
Tama po.
Kaya naguguluhan ang publiko po, ginagamit ating mga salita, a new major player. Wala naman po lang ibig sabihin nito. Ganun po ba?
Actually po, Your Honor, just for purposes of making it easier to call it, yun lang po ang aming tinawag. Actually, pwede rin po ang third player or the third telco. So, it's basically the same, Your Honor.
Anyway. Okay. The... proposed consortium is the new major player. Is that correct?
That is correct, Your Honor.
They are given that royal title. Tama po ba yan?
They are given that name, Your Honor.
A name, all right. Now, but the consortium has no legislative franchise.
Actually, Your Honor,
answer me. The consortium has no legislative franchise.
Actually, Your Honor, the consortium...
Please answer me yes or no.
It has a franchise, Your Honor.
Which is the franchise?
Ms. Latel, Your Honor.
So, Ms. Latel is the franchise holder, not the consortium. As a lawyer, you should know that.
Actually, Your Honor, they have a binding bidding agreement, and then when they bid it, they use the Ms. Latel franchise.
Compañero. When the Congress grants a franchise, the Congress examines the eligibility of the stockholders to discharge the privilege. And that is why Ms. Latel has the franchise. Because the consortium has no franchise.
The consortium, Your Honor, has no franchise right now.
That's correct.
But they will be buying into Ms. Latel and using that Ms. Latel as their franchise,
right.
Your Honor.
So, now... In fact, Ms. Latel is the franchise holder.
Yes, Your Honor.
Now, and the intention is the consortium will buy equity of Ms. Latel.
Yes, Your Honor.
That's correct, right?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Under the terms of the binding agreement, what is the consideration for the transfer?
Maybe Your Honor, Ms. Atel can answer the...
Anyone, yes, can answer. Yes, yes, in the absence of the chair, yes, I'll recognize Senator Tamano.
Thank you, Your Honor. That's my father.
Yes, I know.
Your Honors, under the binding bidding agreement, there is, so it's 25% Chelsea, 35% Udena, and 40% China Telecom. There is...
So how much is that in total percentage?
100%. Po.
Huh?
100%.
Po. So the Mr. Tel will cede 100% control to the consortium?
Yes, Your Honors.
And for how much?
For the for Ms. Latel, the current corporation,
mm-hmm.
They will have 1.25% as equity in the corporation in the newly formed consortium, Your Honor.
Yes, do we have a copy of this binding agreement? I understand this. Binding bidding, this agreement has been submitted to the Secretariat. Can the Secretariat confirm that?
We have a copy, Your Honor, if you would like us to provide you, sir.
Yeah, if you can provide us with that. And my question again is, how much is the purchase price? Yes. Magkano po ang bayad ng consortium for their control of Ms. Latel?
If Your Honor, it's in the binding bidding agreement. At the end of the day,
okay.
So yes. at the end,
on the basis of this, how much?
They will have 0.49%.
No, point?
49% of 10 billion, Your Honor. 0.49%.
You mean they will have no control over Ms. Latel?
Yes, Your Honor.
What yes?
Yes, there will be a change in controlling interest, Your Honor.
The controlling interest will now be?
With the consortium, Your Honor.
With the consortium. Yes, Ms. Latel will lose in controlling interest.
No, Your Honor.
The stockholders.
Yes, Your Honor.
I'm sorry, the stockholders.
Yes, Your Honor.
Present stockholders.
Yes, Your Honor.
Now, and there are, Ms. Latel is the surviving entity because it is the owner or it is the grantee of the franchise.
Yes, Your Honor. May I give just a bit more context, Senator Jalon? If you take a look at the terms of reference, there are two types of participants who can bid.
Mm-hmm.
And the NTC...
Who can bid, okay.
Yes. The NTC said, in its wisdom, decided that the entity must have a franchise. So it can either be a franchise holder, which already has the 10 billion.
Unfortunately, the franchise here of Ms. Latel is doubtful already.
Yes, Your Honor. Yes, Your
Honor. Yes.
We take a different view, Your Honor, but...
Yes, yes.
But what we'd like to say, Your Honor, please, is that there are two types of mm-hmm. participants. The first one is a mm-hmm. simple franchise holder. The second is... and the rationale, as we saw it from the NTC, was so that the consortium would also have a franchise, was that the committed investors in the consortium will be investing equity in the franchise holder, mm-hmm. so that we would reach the level of 10 billion, Your Honor. Mm-hmm. Because the 10 billion requirement, if Your Honor please, is one of the financial requirements of the selection process.
Okay. I'm sorry, can you explain it a bit more?
My apologies, Your Honor. Under the terms of reference, there are three requirements for a participant. There must be a legal requirement, which refers to the nationality requirement, 60-40 at the most,
yes,
if there's a foreign partner. The second is a technical expertise that is defined under the terms of reference. And the third is a capitalization requirement of 10 billion. Mm-hmm. So, Your Honor, in the case of two types of participants, you could be already a franchise holder that has all these requirements plus 10 billion capitalization. But if you look at most of the franchises, hindi po sila ganon. Mm-hmm. That's why they created, under their terms, a way for committed investors to invest equity in the franchise and end up with 10 billion capitalization prior to the issuance po of a CPCN.
Okay, now, very good. In this particular case, the franchise holder being Ms. Latel, there are commitments on record as part, I assume, of the pre-qualification. As for example, as presented here, Ms. Latel endeavors to deliver 27 Mbps of minimum average broadband speed, 55 Mbps after 5 years, covering 37.3% of our country on its first year, and 84% after 5 years. These are the commitments of Ms. Latel. Ms. Latel's franchise was granted on April 19, 1998. Is that correct?
That is correct, Your Honor.
And it is for a period of 25 years?
Correct, Your Honor.
And the 25 years will expire on April 19, 2023. And obviously the commitments are beyond the life of the franchise.
Yes, Your Honor.
And how do you intend to assure compliance with this commitment if your franchise will expire?
That's why, well, first, Your Honor, that's part of the reason we are here. And eventually, po, babalik po kami sa Kongreso so that we can ask for an extension of the franchise.
No, this hearing is not for the franchise of Ms. Latel. No, there is no bill pending before us for the renewal of Ms. Latel's franchise.
Yes, Your Honor.
The commitments are being made for a period beyond the franchise of Ms. Latel.
Madam Chair.
Yes, Your Honor.
Please, yeah. No, it's not wrong. Yeah. This is not wrong. This is a piece of paper which says seeking the concurrence of Congress for the transfer of ownership. Yeah. I am talking about Ms. Latel itself. Even if this is approved, Ms. Latel's franchise will still expire on April 19, 2023.
Yes, Your Honor.
And there are commitments here beyond 2023.
Yes, Your Honor. If I may explain, Your Honors, please.
Please. Uh-uh.
Yes, we were presented that question. Should we go, given the 90-day period, should we go to Congress and ask not only for the approval of controlling interest, but also an extension of the franchise? Now, talking to our legal counsel and taking into consideration that it is an election year, our decision was it would be very difficult to go through the process of extending the franchise.
Why?
I think the level of scrutiny, the number of hearings, given the tight timeline. If Your Honor, please, we were awarded the NMP status in November 19 of 2018. Mm-hmm. And then we knew that Congress would be in break, would only have a certain number of session days. We also knew that after Congress came back, it would be election period. In our judgment, and perhaps we may not have fully understood the consequences of it, we deemed it as a better risk management that in order to comply with the 90 days, we will ask first for a approval of the change in controlling interest. And then once we get the CPCN...
But the change of controlling interest of Ms. Latel,
yes,
was done 2000, 15. And up to now, they have not even sought the approval of Congress.
Yes, Your Honor. We have a legal view on that, if Your Honor, please.
I would be glad to hear that because terms of the franchise are very clear, and we have learned in statutory construction that give the provisions of the law should be interpreted in accordance with common understanding, and very clear here that the franchise holder must secure the consent of Congress if they transfer control, and in this particular case, control was transferred in 2015, we're now 2019. Not even a single document up to this point has been presented to show that they have some respect for Congress by seeking the consent of Congress with the transfer of control of Ms. Datel. And that is something that we will take seriously, at least this representation will take seriously, because in total disregard of the authority of Congress in granting the franchise, Congress was just ignored. They just transferred. Yeah. I'm not talking about the consortium, I'm talking about Ms. Datel.
Yes, Your Honor, and that is why, if Your Honor, please, out of due respect for Congress and the Senate, that is why we are here asking for the approval of change of controlling interest, Your Honor.
Yes, firstly, that is not before us, all right? But more importantly, Ms. Datel itself, the original stockholders, ceased control in 2015. And up to now, they have not secured a congressional approval. In fact, Madam Chair, this has already happened. I will not mention the corporation, although it's public record. A corporation transferred its shares, controlling shares in a franchise, in a corporation holding the franchise. And then subsequently, this new controlling stockholders sold it again to somebody else. And precedent is that they had to secure the approval of the transfer of the first and the second transfer. That we have records to show that the first and the second transfer had to be the consent for the first and second transfer had to be secured.
Senator Drilon, I think the big question here now is this. Secretary Rio, you're still in your vetting process, right? Who will now determine if indeed Ms. Natel has a legitimate franchise? What will convince you that they do? And suppose that you're convinced that they have none, what is our contingency here? Will PT&T or who will be the next candidate to assume the third telco initiative?
Can I answer? Actually, Your Honors, that's why we're here before Congress. Last December, the House of Representatives already approved, so it's subject to your wisdom, Your Honors.
Congress just said that if there are any questions, it will be up to the court to decide. But as Congress,
what was approved?
Actually, Your Honor,
the transfer of...
Yes, Your Honor. I think this is a letter from the Acting Secretary General of the House of Representatives.
Stating that...
Yeah, I have been directed to inform the Senate that the House of Representatives on December 12 adopted House Concurrent Resolution Number 23 entitled Concurrent Resolution Approving the Transfer, Sale, or Assignment of the Controlling Interest of Mindanao Islamic Telecom Incorporated.
Yes.
To which it requests the concurrence of the Senate,
right.
Your Honor.
But the transfer of control in Ms. Latel itself is not before Congress, has not been approved by Congress, and I'm referring to the transfers done in 2015, as testified to here, when the original stockholders transferred and ceded 70% of Ms. Latel to the group of CTE. That transfer of control has never been approved by Congress. And therefore, that puts into doubt the franchise of Ms. Latel. I am not talking about the transfer from Ms. Latel to the consortium, because this is an ongoing process. But the fact of the original stockholders or losing control or ceding control to a new group, which you must admit needs the concurrence of Congress, the concurrence has not been secured, and under the terms of the franchise, it is ipso facto void. So I just want to clarify that there was one transfer and there is a prospective transfer. You're talking about a consent of a prospective transfer. I am talking of a transfer done in 2015. Is that clear, Attorney?
Yes, Your Honor.
And the transfer of 2015 must have had the concurrence, must secure the concurrence of Congress in accordance with the terms of the franchise. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Thank you very much.
So what if the body decides that they don't have a legitimate franchise? That will affect your decision. It should, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
We're all losing in this particular occurrence because lahat tayo nagmamadali na rin talaga na magkaroon ng mas magandang serbisyo. Kaya lang, dahil sa mga technical na bagay na hindi naman natin pwedeng isang tabi lamang, parang nakasalalay ngayon sa desisyon nitong komite. Kung ano yung magiging rekomendasyon namin, kung meron bang prangkisa o wala. So, ibig sabihin, kung sinabi namin walang prangkisa dahil hindi pa ito ina-approbahan namin, hindi matutuloy ito. Senator Zubiri is recognized.
Madam Chair, eventually what we want here is a third player. On my way here, my apologies for being late, I was just elected as a new member of the Philippine Olympic Committee representing Arnis this morning. That's why I was late. But we all want better service for everyone. And what's important here, on my way here, I was trying to send you messages and I still have it unsent. I can't send it because the data signal is very, very bad.
Senator Zubiri, I think that's what we're going to take up next. Huh?
Yes.
Yung cell towers.
Yes.
And the construction of that. Yeah. Go ahead.
But basically, it's the difficulty in getting data service, sending out messages, getting calls, dropped calls. We're all sick and tired of that, and that's the issue here. And with all due respect to all the players, there are now players that want to provide this third service, third telco service to everyone. I can speak for being a Mindanaoan. I know, and I can vouch for Mr. Dennis Uy because I've been friends with him for many, many years. And he's a self-made man with Phoenix Oil and Udena, and he's done himself well, and we in Mindanao are very proud of him. It's very difficult to come into a all-boys club na, I'd say, business community that's more like a fraternity. And for him to reach that level, we in Mindanao are very proud of him. And he's just trying his best to be able to provide that service. I'm not familiar with the presentation of Senator Drilon on what had transpired with Ms. Latel prior to the acquisition of Mr. Dennis Uy. That is a surprise to me. But in fairness to him, he is trying his best. As a matter of fact, he really applied, and I had asked this in one of the occasions of the kapatid parties of Presidential Assistant Joey Concepcion. I asked the very simple and very straightforward questions. I asked him, is this going to be used for any control by another country in our shores? And he said, no way. I will not do that. I will not allow it. Will this be used for any data breach? And he said, no, vehemently, no way. It will not happen. And as a matter of fact, to be very honest about it, the one major carrier is actually using Huawei. As it's, both are using Huawei. So what are we scared of? If everybody in the world is scared of Huawei,
in all our phones now, Huawei na yan. So they're already listening in. So if it's a national security concern, I'm sorry to tell everybody here, nandyan na yan. If you're afraid of Huawei, they're in both our major telecom lines. So I think the fears of Ms. Latel and their consortium is unfounded. And besides, you have a choice whether to join them or to use the original Smart or Globe Telecoms. On the issue on franchises, I have to salute the gentleman for coming to Congress, because as chairman of the Committee on Franchise, I will tell you, former chairman in the House of Representatives, hundreds, if not 90% of franchise holders are in violation. If we go strictly on this and we make a review, we will have to cancel 90% of the franchises, because either they are resold by very industrious gentlemen who apply for franchises and resold again, or there is in time a change of ownership and they do not go to Congress. It's unfortunate, because unless we clear up the amendments and the sections in Congress where it says ipso facto revoke, the question is, who revokes them? Does Congress now have to file ipso facto revoking them? Or does NTC revoke them itself? Or do they have to go to court? It is not clear who will revoke them. Kaya siguro matapang ito mga to magbenta. Even the players, with all due respect, the players who applied, I had checked with my staff, many of them are in violation. Almost all of them are in violation of the franchise laws. Kaya, maybe we should also be not too, kasi if we're going to be really strict about this, with all due respect to my colleagues, di i-cancel na natin lahat. Mag-review na tayo. I will put that as a motion in the committee. Let's review it all. Cancel na natin lahat. With the hell, who will get hit? Let the heavens fall. But that's true. Maraming matataman. Big players, big families, big corporations, and big companies. If you want to open a Pandora's box. Unless we clarify in the rules of the passage of the franchises, who will revoke them? And that is why, ako, I respect these people, because they, before the 90 days expired, they went to Congress. And as a matter of fact, speaking to the chair and members of the Congress of the Legislative Franchise Committee, recommended to them, so that they will not be in violation of the 90-day rule, to just pass the quick concurrent resolution on the ownership issue. And I believe they were told to come back in the next Congress. Mas mahirap pa nga yun. Alam mo, napakahirap mag-file sa Congress and Senate, kasi you have to talk to 300 people. I know Mr. Asindo has done this twice or three times. And I'm surprised he still has a jet black hair. And it's very difficult. So, but they're going to take the risk. They're here to apply for the transfer of ownership. And I believe in the next Congress, they will apply for the extension of the franchise. So not like the others that I know. Na after they get the franchise, goodbye Philippines. Di na pinapansin yung Kongreso or the responsibilities written down in the franchise. So that's the statement that I'd like to make, Madam Chair. It's up to the committee on what they want to do. But if we do that, then I would suggest let's do it for all.
Yeah, Senator Zubiri.
So it does not look biased. It does not look biased na pinitira natin sila kasi malapit sila sa whoever it may be. Then gawin natin, let's review all para fair ang committee.
Well, aside from exercising our oversight function in this particular hearing, we're also learning from this in aid of legislation. So you've seen the deficiency of the law or the vagueness of the wordings. Perhaps the good senator can submit to us a clearer wording, and that's where we need to amend our franchise agreements. On the other hand, I don't think everybody will be in violation of one thing or another. But I think that it is clear in the law that it says if you don't have a public offering of your stocks and you're not in operation, those two particular requirements are the ones that have the line that says ipso facto revoke.
Actually, Madam Chair, on that issue lang on the public offering, on the issue lang, with all due respect to my minority leader, on the issue lang on the public offering, 70% na dyan, tanggal na. To be very honest. Because I passed it in 2002 when I was chairman all the way to 2006 or 2007, several franchises that have not gone public still. So they are in violation of the franchises.
Madam Chair, just to put things on record, unfortunately, my good colleague, Senator Sibiri, was not here. But in my statements, I have never referred to Mr. Uy. I was raising an issue.
Not you, sir.
I was raising the issue of Ms. Latell disregarding the Senate and the House when it transferred control in 2015, ignoring the Senate, ignoring Congress, and they did not even care until this came up. So, to me, this is a gross violation of their franchise, which has been there for the past 3 years. What do we do? Just to put it under the rug might be a slippery slope that we will be confronted with. So this is an issue which I have placed squarely. This is not, we are not talking about the consent of Congress with the transfer of the control of Vistatel to the consortium, but it is the previous transfer of control of Vistatel in 2015, even before Mr. Uy and the consortium came into being. Just to clarify for the record.
So I think with this particular experience, maybe we can have like supplemental law amending our franchises just to clarify that particular point. But in the meantime, I think we're actually in a tug of war debating. We, for national interest, for the interest of our country, we really want this to move forward. So we have to find a way wherein we'll still honor the law and clarify it based on interpretation, just so this can move forward. That's where the dilemma lies. I would really want this to push through, but we don't also want to be in violation of our own laws. I think somebody from PTNT, sir.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would just like to point out and put on record that we did bid, and therefore we are interested, and we would believe that we have the capability to provide the requirements. And point out the fact that we are a major player since the past 50 years. Okay, in the technical term, we have what the International Telecommunications Union calls Tier 1, Tier 2, Tier 3 telcos. And we are a Tier 1 telco. And we have participated in the bid, and we have also submitted such that we did qualify also on the qualification for 10 billion without the need for a consortium. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. At least we have an alternative in the unfortunate event that this falls through. And I say unfortunate not because of a particular bias for a group, but because we all lose every time we delay a process like this, an opportunity to upgrade our telco services. If my colleagues agree, I would like to go now to another issue that can actually help with our signal, and that's with the tower issue, the common tower issue. So for the common towers, one of the key initiatives of the administration to support a new major telco player is the shared telco infrastructure or the common cell towers policy. The policy includes the measure to remove all future cell tower building activities from companies, PLDT Globe. The government will instead employ two independent tower companies to do so. But I think that the DICT has already come up with a memorandum of understanding or agreement allowing more than just two companies in building. Please clarify this, Secretary Rio.
Yes, Your Honor. In my opening statement, I mentioned that while we are formulating a new common tower policy, and we went ahead because we could no longer wait, open up the market, and just came up with MOUs with all interested common tower providers. No? And that MOU simply states, Your Honor, that we recognize you as a capable tower company, and this will more or less be your passport to go to the telcos and get business from them. And once you get a business from them, then the ICT, or the whole government will in fact, will support you, no, in terms of permits, because these are the number of complaint of the telcos that they need 25 permits. Some takes about 8 months to approve. So we'll take care of that. Even site acquisition, we can take care of that. So this actually invited so many. You know? We are now five, and I think there are still three who would like to sign with us in the MOU.
Okay. So I'd like a clarification from our presidential advisor, Mr. Jacinto. You have come up with a memorandum of, let me just look at this document, a joint memorandum circular, Department of Information and Communications Technology and National Telecom Commission, and part of that proposal, of that policy, is future deployment of all telecommunications towers shall be performed only by the tower companies registered by the NTC, except where the MNO demonstrates that the tower company is unable, despite requests and lapse from the request, to provide the facility to the MNO, in which the case the MNO itself can build its own towers. And this is actually, and are you limiting this to the number of cell tower builders? Are we understanding this correctly?
Madam Chair, may I be allowed to read a statement?
Go ahead, please.
Thank you, Madam Senator, for inviting me today to explain the common tower policy, as I believe it has not been adequately explained or understood by the public. I believe in your resolve to bring better service to our countrymen. The common tower policy is a part of the cabinet's holistic approach to address the problem of poor telecommunications and broadband service in the country today. The entire premise of this is that our dominant telcos, Globe and Smart, have failed to deliver the service the Filipino people need and deserve. The Philippines lags behind our Asian neighbors and is the third to the last in speed in the whole world and coverage. And yet, our service is some of the most expensive in the world. The government's present approach to resolving the problem of poor service has three parts. The third telco is one, and that has gone ahead. The common tower policy and a review of government's connectivity and present policy on satellite services. The last two parts were given to my office to take charge of and implement through the NTC. On July 5, my office released a set of guidelines, and Acting Secretary Rio approved the policy. And he made some changes on morning of July 5 before our press conference, which we adopted. And we jointly held a press conference. And we have a picture there of the press conference. However, Acting Secretary Rio did not transmit these guidelines to the NTC and instead requested me, though not required by law, to subject the policy and guidelines to a public forum. He also agreed that if the results of the public forum were favorable, he would issue the guidelines. In September 2018, we then had a public forum. The attendees of the public forum, which included prospective tower co's, investors, civic groups, and the telcos, were then asked to submit their position papers.
The submitted position papers, the investors supported it. So the news that there was a lot of opposition is not true. In the public forum, Globe verbalized their intention to be the common tower company. In the press releases and public discussion that have since ensued, I believe that my office guidelines have been purposely misrepresented and consequently misunderstood by the public. So I'm thankful that I have this opportunity to discuss them today. The current public discussion on the common tower has centered on the limitation of the number of towers to two. Allow me to address this issue directly. I firmly believe that taken in its entirety together with the rest of the provisions of my policy, my office's policy, this limitation is not anti-competitive. My policy requires that the telcos utilize all their future towers, the services of tower companies who can concentrate on building towers that will be shared amongst not only the duopoly, but the ISPs, the small operators, and even the cable TV companies and other telecommunications industry participants. The number of common tower companies will be limited only to two, but only for 4 years, just to have an orderly, regulated, and high-quality rollout. It's meant to enhance the viability of the tower cos. We are asking a 200 billion peso investment from the foreign investors. We cannot have everybody build a tower because a tower is a special engineering technique also. It's just not steel. It contains a lot of fiber, power supply, and other engineering feats. The first 6 months of the implementation period is a build-up period during which the tower companies will agree with the telcos on the rollout. We will go to a digital map and tell them this is where we plan to build the 50,000 towers. And then they can comment, and then if they agree, they should sign on it. The pace of the rollout and the number of towers and the locations. The tower costs can still build if, the telcos can still build if the tower cos, upon a request of one, within 30 days they have to answer yes or no. If they say no, then the operators can build. So if we're not banning them really from building. We cannot have too many participants which will dilute the market. I would rather rely on a tower company who will put hard money in than too many who may not be viable. We will give accredited tower companies a schedule of rollout, as I said. The policy is thus a measured regulatory intervention to address poor service. It is key to enhance the tower's viability for the policy to succeed. Limiting the number of tower cos avoids the mistakes made in other countries, which started out with a totally open policy only to see the tower co industry consolidate and ultimately settle to the global norm. The global norm is half the number, the tower companies are half the number of the telcos. Even India, which is commonly cited as a model for not limiting the number of tower cos, is now seeing a string of bankruptcies in the tower co industry and a trail of wasted capital in the process. I would also like to add that the present discussion totally misses what is in the heart of the policy, which is tower sharing. The policy's principal purpose was to mandate telecommunications companies to share their towers. This is something that the DICT and NTC has not pursued, even to this day. It has not passed any memorandum circular or policy guideline mandating the telcos to share their existing towers and future towers. The second important element of the policy is independence. We want the tower cos to be independent of the telcos, and it should prohibit them from owning any equity in the tower cos so they cannot exercise undue influence. Because there are only two of them now, possibly three later. If you have 100 tower companies, they can pick and choose and they can dictate, and they'll be in the driver's seat again. Doing so is the only means to promote tower sharing and achieve transparent and non-discriminatory tower sharing terms. The telco's history in interconnection shows it. They did not interconnect until recently. And to get telcos to share the facilities and to make the terms of access fair and transparent to access seekers, even the small guys. If you allow the telcos to own the tower cos, there will be no other tower cos, but their own captive tower cos, and no tower sharing as a result. I would like to point out that contrary to what is being said in the newspapers, the position papers submitted by the aspiring tower cos all supported my guidelines, or the guidelines of my office. It was only the operators who opposed it. Naturally, they want to protect their business. The DICT, however, has ignored this and instead amplified the position of the telcos to make it appear that my guidelines were heavily opposed. It is opposed only by the telcos, as I said. If I may venture, this is the reason why they do not build according to a pace other than their own. They must be mandated to build at a certain pace. If you're asking for a performance bond from the third telco, why don't we ask for a performance bond also from the present telcos to commit to a rollout? And if they don't, you know, we withdraw the bond. For 20 years, the telcos have been in the driver's seat, rolling out, providing coverage only when it is most profitable for them. And in this age of broadband, providing broadband speed only at the slowest minimum. Their game is dominance. Dominance now, public service very much later. They would spend more to shut out the competitors than to improve public service. Exclusivities in infrastructure have for two decades been a weapon in their arsenal to maintain their dominance. Bereft of choice, our long-suffering people have learned to live with their bad service. The Duterte administration is now trying to change that. First, by introducing the third telco. Second, by eliminating the duopoly's dominance in infrastructure as a competitive differentiator. The survival of the third telco, by and large, for a large part, depends on the success of an independent common tower policy.
Mr. Jacinto, yeah. I think we understand your point.
Yeah, may I summarize?
Can you please wrap up?
Yeah. When there is a failure of public service and it is affecting the people, the government cannot just stand by. It must intervene. So we need a mandated common tower policy. We only have 10,000 locations. We need 50,000. And the rollout of Smart last year, as submitted to the NTC, was 617 towers. At this rate, it will take more than 81 years to achieve 50,000 towers. So we must intervene, as we did in Boracay. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Mr. Jacinto, I will give you the benefit of the doubt. I understand certain points that you made, and I appreciate it. For example, a shared common tower policy wherein cable providers and telco providers can avail of that. On the other hand, what is ironic is why we're in a hurry to roll out these plans, limiting it to two players is quite suspect. And I look at it in this particular point of view that, yes, the telco companies are not as fast in rolling out and building these cell towers, but government also is to blame for this. Number one, it takes so many steps and permits from the local government and the national government to be able to erect one cell tower. Number two, there are also areas in the country where homeowners, and understandably so, don't like a cell tower within their area. That's why service is also not as clear. So there are many factors, and not just the telecommunication companies' shortcomings. That's the reason why we have a shortage of cell towers. And it's just illogical for me to accept that even the telco companies will not be allowed to build their own cell towers if there is already a policy of a shared tower agreement. So let me ask now, Secretary Rio, nasa na ba tayo sa shared common tower policy?
Meron na ba po? May directive na ba ang DICT o wala pa rin?
Yes, Your Honor, and definitely it is not the the draft common tower policy that RJ is suggesting. Basically, the government will be creating a duopoly, and the one who will really choose the towers are not is not the government. It will be the telcos. So why are we now going to limit their choice? Why will government that has no little experience than the telcos have, they have been there for more than 20 years, they know how to build towers, they know the problem, and we are actually realizing that problem. It is actually per number of permits, sometimes graft and corruption. This is what we are addressing as the ICT.
Sino po, dun po sa draft ni Mr. Jacinto, sino bang mamimili ng dalawang kumpanya?
Gobyerno po.
Sino gobyerno? Sa gobyerno?
Yes, and then how will we... So kung magkakaroon tayo ng selection process ulit for two, and then we will force the telcos to just choose among the two, and they will not be in fact even allowed to put up their own...
Pero target. Hindi naman natin patutupad to, di ba? You already issued a statement that anybody can build a tower as
yes,
long as they...
Yes, Your Honor. That's why we said, and it is being accepted now by the telcos, no?
Hindi kasi ganito po yan, Mr. Jacinto. I understand your concern, as I said, that to build it, there are certain standards. But that standard naman is also determined by which particular agency. Di ba dapat papasa yan?
No, Your Honor. The telcos are the one who will provide the standards of their of towers where they will connect the radios, no? Hindi ho gobyerno yan. We never have any standard for common towers.
Except safety. Yes. Di ba pagdating sa safety,
yes,
the structure yon.
It is the telcos that give the standard. They will not put the radios on substandard common towers. Never.
Kaya nga.
Kaya nga ho, sila ho dapat magpili kung sino yung mga interested na common tower. And there are many, no? In ASEAN, there are already 10. And in fact, I don't know if RJ can say, sino sa buong mundo ang nag-limit ng tower code to just two? Sino sa buong mundo ang regulator did not allow MNOs to put up their own towers?
No? I agree. That's why this particular proposal of Mr. Jacinto will not be implemented, right?
As long as I am the acting secretary of the ICT, ma'am, it will not be implemented.
And in fact, I have...
And ma'am, yes. I am the one who is supposed to sign this policy, no?
Mm-mm. And as you were not going to sign it.
Hindi si RJ magpuhi. Ako po. And ako ho yung dadalhin sa korte ng mga lahat na mag-object nitong policy nito.
Pero
I think
I can speak for my colleagues. A lot of us agree with your position that we should allow more players to come in when it comes to even the building of these cell towers. Just limiting it to two. Nakakatakot yan mamaya. Palpak yung dalawa, mas lalo pa tayong matagalan. I'm sorry, Mr. Jacinto, maybe your intentions are good and I see that you have some points, but limiting it to two is, will, I feel, further delay us and add more complications. You are raising your hand, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Our point from Now Telecom and Now Corporation are as follows. Baka sa pagmamadali na naman po natin for a tower company, we might forget again. For example, the stance that you need a congressional franchise to erect, to build towers. No, this is part of the telecommunications congressional franchise to build these things. And also, for
you don't need a congressional franchise.
Okay, to highlight lang po, it's part of electronic communications networks and electronics communication services. This might be a gray area part, but this might be an area wherein those telcos with congressional franchises, with professional provisional authorities should be considered. What I'm telling ma'am is that, say for example, with the problems of the third telco, with the problem of Ms. Latel, we want them to succeed, but we want them also to be abiding by the law.
Okay, I'm sorry. I would like now to ask Secretary Rio, do you already have a draft
agreement that for shared tower services?
Yes.
O, pumayag na ba yung mga telco dyan?
Yes, madam. December 20, we signed the first MOU. And now there are five who are now actually going to the telcos. And the telcos are accepting them.
Oh, so the telcos, Globe, Attorney Castelo, you agree. For example, merong mga cable companies din sa mga probinsya gustong makishare na rin dun sa tower ninyo para hindi na rin pangit na napakaraming tinatayo. Yan ba'y pinapayagan ng Globe?
Yan po ang gusto namin hong mangyari. A multiplayer environment in the tower co and partnerships with all the stakeholders in a particular area.
Pero who companies. Determines, Attorney Castelo, who determines the fees? Kunyari, makikikabit dun.
That's what we're talking now with the tower companies. They have on the tower sharing side, the tower companies now giving us the pricing. Their pricing for
who's
for
giving
such.
You the pricing again, sir?
The prospective tower companies which signed an MOU with the DIC.
Now how about the existing towers that you already have? Are you sharing that also?
Yes, so that's our intention.
And who determines the pricing for that?
It's still undergoing due diligence by our partner, that's Universal Bank of Switzerland. So we have not yet actually provided any pricing for that until full evaluation has been made.
I think that's the point also of Mr. Jacinto. Because if the dominant players are also the dominant cell providers, and they will dictate how much it will be to share their towers, which might limit also the players. That's one of the risks. So how do we guarantee that they will play fairly in the market, Secretary Rio?
Just make the market forces play, you know. All of this, the telcos have a number of choices. They will get the best in their interest, they get the best offer that each tower co will give them, and therefore they will go into a business transaction with them. So let market forces do this. Do not let the government choose who these two tower co will be and force the telco to just select in the these two. No? Let
tama kayo, sir. Di ba parang ganito lang yan eh. Pagka pinayagan natin, maski sino, basta pumasa yung standards sila, magtayo ng cell towers, edi pwedeng pumili yung mga ibang players na, okay, dito ako sa cell tower na to dahil mas mura dito kesa dun sa kabila. Eh kung ililimit lang natin sa dalawa pa, baka mahirapan tayo. Mr. Jacinto.
May I say something?
Yes, sir.
If we have an open tower policy at the start, what is to prevent the operators to form their own, you know, dummy tower companies? Or if we still allow them to build, we are making the cost of the problem the solution. They are the cause of the problem. For two decades, they only built 8,000 locations, duplications, 16,000 towers. Indonesia's 250 million people has 100,000 towers. I'm sorry, but if I'm passionate about this, Madam Chair, I would like to say this very respectfully, that we cannot allow them again to be in the driver's seat because they have failed the people. And they'll be in the driver's seat if they're allowed to own.
Yes, but sir, okay. Yeah. So if you don't allow them, others will come in. What's your guarantee that they will perform better?
Okay. Then you have very responsible companies, big companies. The biggest company is American Tower. They were the ones that suggested to me, only two and don't make them own.
Well, precisely because they want to make money, so they'll limit it to two players.
I understand that.
Are you being influenced by this American company?
No, it's not that. Madam Chair, the others also support it. ISOC, ATC, yeah. China Energy, the others also support
it. I think Senator Zubiri has a good point. Yeah. Sir, come on, say it on record.
With all due respect, alam mo si Manong RJ is a very good family friend, but it just boggles the mind that you're against a duopoly, but we're setting up a duopoly.
Yeah. It is very hard to understand it. That's why I ask for your open mind.
No, we understand clearly.
For example,
I'm giving you the benefit of the doubt that your intentions are good, sir.
Yeah.
Because I listen to you all the time, and you play well. But
it is not true that there is no country that is limiting. It's not true what Secretario said. There's no country that is limiting the tower cost. China has 3 operators, 1 tower co. Sri Lanka, 5 operators, 1 tower co. Afghanistan, 6 operators, 1 tower co.
Sila ba yung mga gusto natin, Sundin? Ang Afghanistan is one of the slowest internet.
Excuse me. No, but China is, okay.
China is not, they don't have the same democratic system as we do.
That's why.
I mean, they don't have
Vietnam.
I mean, it's a
Vietnam,
state-owned.
Cambodia, 2 tower co, 5 players. America, okay, America. 5 dominant players, 3 tower companies. Why? Because building towers should not be influenced.
But is it the policy of the United States government to limit it to 3? No, because only 3 are interested.
Yes. They have very mature markets. We are in a dominant market play. They didn't even want to interconnect. They don't want to improve their service. We're the slowest. Okay. Why will we trust them to own a tower, the tower company?
Well, anyway, I just believe in competition. So the more their players are, the more incentive it is for them to compete and provide better service.
Madam Chair, it's only for 4 years. Madam Chair, it's only for 4 years.
Yeah, 4 years na may kikita dyan ng 4 years.
For an orderly
kasi
rollout.
Kasi tama na yung 4 years kung marami ka ng kinita, di ba? Pero talo ang taong bayan dyan.
Would you like a mayor of a corrupt mayor of a town to put up his own tower co in partnership with others? Do you think he will give a permit to the others? Huh?
And, sir, first of all, okay, the mayor doesn't give a permit. This is something that the DICT and the rest will have to be able to work with the NTC and call them out. Hindi naman pwede kasi, tingnan mo, what's also stopping the mayor from making money from these two tower companies na pigilin sila para lamang makakubra? Diba? I mean, either way, corruption is corruption. But we can't limit, again.
Yeah.
This is not a point that I'd like to harp on. I think we are already, but I think we both made our points here.
Madam Chairman, I just put one last
Go ahead,
on
sir.
Record. The MOUC signing is not binding. It does not mandate anybody. Now, my authority from the President is very clear. I take charge of the guidelines and oversee its implementation through the NTC. Not even through the ICT. I can put it up there in the screen if you wish. So,
saying is your recommendation has authority.
Yes.
And they need to follow it.
Well,
has the president signed on your recommendation?
No.
Okay.
Not yet. But only the cabinet can change it. Not Secretary Rio.
Madam Chair.
Okay.
We have our regular cabinet meetings. We'll come back to you after we reconcile the positions.
Yes.
General Esperon, I hear that you're also in favor of Mr. Jacinto's two-tower.
No. In fact, I've talked to them separately. They are in the 2 limit of Mr. Jacinto is not really up to. He can go for 5.
Correct.
Here we have 5 MOUs and probably 3 more. We'll just,
Madam Chair.
We'll just come back with the final position coming from the cabinet after the cabinet meeting.
Sir.
Madam Chair, we can go 2, 3, 4, 5, fine, but they must share their existing towers. That's my recommendation, and it cannot be open to everybody. That's the cap. It has to have a cap.
Secretary Rio.
Yes, Madam Chair. The facts of RJ are somewhat misleading. No? He says Vietnam has only 4 telcos. Yeah, that's okay. But Vietnam has more than 20. You can check this in tower. Yes, exchange. No. Indonesia has 3 tower cos. They have more than 50 tower. In fact, madam, the way the Vietnamese and they have more towers than us, very fast. The way they did it was to offer it, in fact, to a mom and pop shop. In other words, if I am a family and I have a lot and I have the investment to put up a tower, it is much less than putting up a 3-door apartment. If I put up a 3-door apartment, I will have problem in getting tenants, maintaining it. But if I have a tower call, a common tower, I'm sure that forever, almost forever, the telcos will lease it, no? So this will generate, as it did in Vietnam, as it did in Indonesia, and as it did in Malaysia, it really generated a new type of investment, a new type of business.
Secretary Riot, when you build a cell tower, you have to get the permit of the DNR? Ano bang mga government agencies ang dapat mag-sign off to build a cell tower? Siguro si Attorney Cordova. Sino-sino mga, ano mga government agencies po ang nagbibigay ng permit para sa common towers? I mean, para sa cell towers?
Your Honors, for the radios, it's our office, but we do it very fast. And then there's, if it's near airport, you have to get permit from the CAAP.
Yung DNR ba, kinokonsultan?
I think, Your Honors, ano, yes.
Hindi lang local government, diba? May national government component.
Yes, national government. I think, Your Honors, maybe the telcos can say, but it's a national
Attorney
government.
Attorney Castelo, ano po yung mga
government? Yes, ma'am. The regular permits are from the NTC.
Okay.
The DNR, which is the Environmental Compliance Certificate application from the Department of Health. So if you live in nearby airports, you need to have clearance from the ATO, from the Air Transportation Office. If that is beside any port or whatever, you need to get approval from the marina or whatever agency that controls it. And then there are a lot of, if you're in Palawan, you need to get from the province council development agency.
So marami talaga. So Attorney Castelo, the fear that, you know, it will just sprout out of nowhere is not necessarily a concern because they need to get the permit also from the DNR, kung okay, or Department of Health. So let's say I'm in a subdivision and I have a parcel of land. I can't just build a cell tower there without the DOH compliance and also the homeowners, correct?
And it is being duplicated on the local government level. If you have already a DOH clearance, you would have to get a health clearance also from the LGU, an environmental clearance also from the LGU.
Okay.
So the permit starts from the...
Madam Chair, so the public will understand. Can you slowly enumerate the licenses that a prospective tower builder would have to secure before they can put up one tower? Because here, part of our panel here is Senator Subiri, who has been jumping up and down with the delay because of all these licenses being granted. So just for the record, can you enumerate how many licenses and which government agency is involved before you can put up one tower?
There's an average of 26 permits, Your Honor.
How many?
26 permits.
26 permits?
That's correct. Average, Your Honor. It can be 29 because there are...
26 permits average before you can put up one tower?
Yes, Your Honor.
Mr. Subiri, you know, you the ease of doing business.
We actually, Mr. President, with the support of Senator Dillon, to be honest, when we crafted the ease of doing business, we put up a special provision during the bicameral conference. Actually, it was during the plenary provision on telco towers expansion. I don't have, you know what? I will get it now and read it on record. I'll find it.
Yeah, but anyway, 26. May I know if, let's say, Vietnam or Indonesia, which has more towers than us, what are they? Would the tower owners have the same problem, or how do they solve? Maybe we can recognize Secretary Rio because I'm concerned about this issue, Mr. Rio, Secretary Rio.
Your Honor, we don't have the exact permits needed in Indonesia, but I think it is very much less than what we have here. And in fact, Your Honor, we are now using the ease in doing business in that MOU that we signed. We are actually now creating an interagency that will make the giving of permits very much 7 days, Your Honor, as per the law. We will abide by that. And if anybody will not abide by that, then we will use the law to really go after them. 7 days, Your Honor, not 18 months. So we are actually using now the ease in doing business.
And of course, we have other laws like the free Wi-Fi law, where the ICT can put up our towers, and of course, the DICT law itself. So these three laws are what we are now telling the Telco, sign MOUC that we will take care of all the legal problems of government.
So are you saying that we can reduce these 26 licenses that confronts the tower, the Telco?
Initially, Your Honor, we may not be able to reduce that, but we will make it faster. So the 26, we can do it in 1 month. But of course, we are going into that direction to reduce really the number of towers. But the number one problem is really corruption. LGUs would tend to delay giving the permits if there is no...
Which is answered, Mr. President, Madam Chair, with the ease of doing business, because they can no longer delay under the law. If they do, they're in violation of the law. And very strong penalties.
If it's not complete, if the license is not issued within X number of days, it is deemed issued.
Approved.
Yes.
So that is why in our MOU, we are going to enforce that, Your Honor.
Okay, I think that we need to wrap up already the issue on the Telco.
Yeah, I was just trying to get a copy of the ease of doing business. But for all the Telco players here, there is a particular section just for the Telco players.
We were the one. The ICT was the one who put that section there.
It's impossible that you could put it, sir, because you're not a senator.
That is going to be part of
you assisted us in putting that section. But really, it was our hearings where we took that up, that the problem really on the Telco, bad Telco telecommunications connections is due to the tower problem,
which we took up. Yes, yeah.
With all due respect, sir, kasi, syempre, kami yung lawmakers. But thank you for the information.
Just to highlight the point, Madam Chair, I'm looking at this, the permits, 26, okay, dalawang pulang po yan dito, consent of the neighbors. Barangay resolution, certificate of non-coverage by the EMB, zoning clearance by the LGU, height clearance by the CAAP, radiation evaluation study by the DOH, ano pa? Building permit by the LGU.
Kanino bang requirements yan? Sino nagsabi ganyan kadami?
Karamihan po, ma'am, sa local government code here.
These are various laws, Madam Chair, which, without being conscious of what was required in another law, we'll just enacted laws or somebody issued regulation. But just to continue, you have the height clearance, you have the radiation evaluation study, you have the building permit, you have the height clearance, you have the memorandum of agreement with DNR NIPAS. We have the waiver of the steward, Jesus Christ, application for free, prior, and informed consent. Eto, mamamatay ka rito. You will die before you get this, in other words. A city or municipal resolution, occupancy permit. Do you occupy towers? So, if we do not occupy towers, why do we need an occupancy permit? Really, this government is crazy. Occupancy permit, application for local power connection, mayor's permit, tower fee ordinances, LGU, special use permit for its cell site. Compilation with compliance with DPWH Department Order Number 73 on right of way. Permit to operate generator set. Registration of generator set.
DNR. Oh.
Ano ba ito? Certificate of hazardous waste generator. I'm missing 6 here, but this is how stupid this system is. No wonder. I'm sure this is part of the problem. And
dyan yung revolutionary tax.
Oh, hindi, sabi niya, wala pa daw yung revolutionary tax dito. So, but really, this, you know, we're just taking it, you know, with lightly because it has reached the point of being ridiculousness. And I'm sure this is not only true in the issue of cell towers. We suffer from the same difficulty all over. I suggest that, I do not know, maybe it calls for time, Sandra Subiri, that we looking at your at the ease of doing business, I do not know if we need special legislation just for the cell tower, put it all under the DICT, all siya lang magbigay ng permit, and it's the responsibility to get all of these permits from everywhere, from the entire bureaucracy, rather than letting the cell tower operator or the telco run for after 26 licenses. We should only locate it in one agency and let that agency get all of these permits from the 26 agencies we enumerate.
Precisely, Your Honor, if I may. We are actually now coming up with a one-stop shop where all of these permits will be done by us.
Problema mo is that these permits are required because of the legislation and the laws which Congress passed.
Default functions.
For example, taxation. Issuance of the prior informed consent. Jesus Christ, you not move that to you. The goddamn NCIP will complain.
Yes, Your Honor.
So we must pass a law.
Yes, Your Honor.
In my view.
But pending that law, Your Honor, we will punish those who will go beyond the 7-day. Doon na ho kami magtututok.
Ah, pwede yun. Yeah, pwede.
Grace,
I think,
Madam Grace, just Madam Chairperson, I just want to point out that under the ease of doing business, under Section 15, we have what we call the interconnectivity infrastructure development. This is to answer the call of the problems of the slow data and slow internet. In order to expedite the processing of licenses, clearances, permits, certifications, or authorizations, the authority, together with the DICT, shall develop a fast and reliable interconnectivity infrastructure in relation to this approval of licenses, etc., etc. Number one, total of 7 working days for those issued by the barangay. 7 lang lahat. Total of 7 working days for those issued by the LGU from the council. Total of 7 working days for those issued by the National Government Association. So 7 days lang lahat. If the granting authority fails to approve or disapprove any application for license, clearances, permit, certification, etc., within the prescribed processing time, the application shall be deemed approved, provided that when the approval is a legislative body, kasi minsan kukuha ka ng sanggunian approval, they only have a non-extendable period of 20 working days from application. So mag-apply ka Monday to the sanggunian bayan of Makati, sanggunian panlusod of Makati or Quezon City, they have only 20 working days to act upon it, of which it will be deemed approved. You will already have an approved council resolution. And it says here, continuation, for homeowners and other community clearances, the officers of the homeowners association shall be given 10 working days to refer the application of the members of the association pursuant to Section 10, Republic Act 9904, otherwise known as the Magna Carta for Homeowners and Homeowners Association. I was also the author of that. Provided that the non-extendable period of 30 working days is granted to the homeowners association, which is good because now, before Rio came in, matagal yung homeowners, abot ng taon. Walang permit na binibigay, walang answer. So, in the case of disapproval, the granting authority shall notify the applicant and requesting party within the prescribed period the reasons for disapproval, as well as the remedial measures that may be taken by the applicant or requesting party. Because the time limitation does not also say it's a yes. The time limitation can be also a no. But they have to justify why they're not granting you your permit. So within 3 months, the DICT shall come up with the IRR. So ang importante dito, sir, is the DICT and the ARTA. Please remind the members of the cabinet, Mr. Jun, yung ARTA, until now we have no appointment of the head of the anti-red tape authority. That is the key to get all this done because the director general of the ARTA will be the one filing cases against erring government offices. importante talaga yan. Yan yung parang Elliot Ness natin for all these corrupt activities being done by the local government. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Okay, I think that we've discussed quite a bit already for this third telco issue. So I'll just summarize it so you guys will be excused soon. First, I'd like to thank Mr. Dennis Uy for accepting our invitation for being here. The importante na nakilala ka ng ating mga kababayan. Sa tingin ko naman, nakita nila na bilang Pilipino, may sinceridad rin naman tayo na gusto natin mapabuti talaga ang kalagayan ng ating bansa. Malaking tulong yung sa telco. Tama ka, talagang butas ng karayom ang pinagdaraanan mo ngayon. Hindi naman ito panghuhusga sa pagkatao mo, kundi para lang masiguro na tinutupad natin ang ating mga mandato at pinapatupad natin ang ating batas. But we wish you the best of luck because a success of any company that will be able to provide better internet service, cell service to our country is very much welcome. So thank you again, sir, for your presence here today. Now the DICT through Secretary Rio updated the committee on the major player and shape passive in telecommunications infrastructure that MISLA Telco Consortium was declared the provisional new major player on November 7, 2018, that MISLA Telco committed and will endeavor to deliver 27 Mbps of internet speed in the country, hopefully, within the first rollout. Secretary Esperon committed to provide us, the committee, an assessment check background test on all involved participants of the consortium. In the timeline in late February, this is to secure the country's security vis-a-vis telecommunications in the Philippines. Minority Leader Senator Drilon questioned the background of Ms. Latel, citing its non-operation from the time 1998 when Ms. Latel was given a franchise. Please note that the binding agreement requires that the willing bidder should be operational too. There are questions too on the disbursement, on the dispersed ownership, increase in the capitalization, the share of Bank of China in the investments in Ms. Latel. But then it was answered and say by Mr. Uy by saying that his other businesses also provided capital, infused capital for here their investment. The new major player, NMP, was explained as a third industry player to be able to compete head-to-head against the two existing players that we have now. Commissioner Cordova admitted that the consortium did not have a legislative franchise, but they will be using the franchise of Ms. Latel. The minority leader stated for the record that the concurrent resolution approving the transfer sale control of Ms. Latel is not enough to fulfill the requirements of the binding bidding agreement, which is a franchise. Senator Subiri committed to draft a provision that may serve as a leeway on operation and ipso facto revocation, the same subject to the committee's approval. Both the DICT Secretary and Presidential Advisor Jacinto submitted their positions on common tower policy. The chair noted that for purposes of fairness and fast internet, the committee's position is to allow market players to construct cell towers and not to limit them to just two players. So with that, we thank you again, our resource persons, for your presence here today. I will suspend this hearing for 10 minutes because after this, we will continue with the franchise hearings for the many different other franchises. So the rest of you are excused. 10-minute break.